The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer Steve Carlisi.
Hello, my name is E-Rock, and welcome to the Steve Carlisi Tribute Special. For those of you who don't know, you should know at this point if you are a regular listener to the show, but our old producer and friend, Steve Carlisi, recently passed away. Now, it was very unexpected and shocking to everybody, not just his family and friends, but to those of us here on the show. And based on all the emails, the tweets, and phone calls that we got from you, the listeners, it affected you as well. So we thought we got to do something to honor the memory of our good pal, Steve C., as you may know him on the air. So we put this little thing together. It's going to feature a whole bunch of stuff that explores the history of Steve with this show, from his character traits to stupid things that he's said on the air or off the air, personal interests, his choice in music, whole bunch of stuff we're going to go through here. Plus, we're going to have some testimonials from people who've worked with Steve in various capacities at WNEW, at CBS K-Rock, at XM, at Sirius XM. So let's get started here and plow through all this the best that we possibly can. We'll start off with the first show that we did on XM Satellite Radio back in October of 2004, where Steve was announced as a returning member of the Opie and Anthony Show in a producer capacity, where he was the production guy back at CBS WNEW. Here it is.
We have a bunch of degenerates now working for us. We were supposed to upgrade our staff. We had 2 years to try to upgrade and fill in the dead spots, and I really believe we effed up bad. We got a bunch of alcoholics working behind the scenes now.
Well, if the little publicity tour we've been taking over the past month or 2 months or whatever it's been, if that's any indication, we're in serious trouble.
Yeah.
Serious trouble. Because I have never seen so many drunks in my life. I got to say, Steve. Oof. Steve C., he...
Wait a minute. You could just talk from in there?
Oh, yeah, now I can.
Oh, there he goes.
There we go.
Wait, now we can't hear him. What?
No, you can't
hear
this?
I can't hear him in my headphones.
He reminds me of somebody.
How about now?
Steve, get in here. All You're right. not landing a plane. My God.
He's behind the glass.
He's already too comfortable. He just needs a martini. Do we have the Martini Steve music yet?
Dylan!
That's all we got?
Pretty much it. Oh, that's all we're working with.
People
right
going to pay for this crap?
Dylan!
We need a few more sound bites before people go, you know what? I'd pay for the Opie and Anthony Show.
I know.
What's up, Steve? Have you slept in the last 3 days?
A little bit. I went to bed around midnight last night. Woke up at 3.
Right. Well, here's the second member of the Opie and Anthony Show.
Old change purse stomach.
Yeah.
And Steve, who was running foundrymusic.com, continues to run that. The unofficial Opie and Anthony website
right.
is now officially a member of the Opie and Anthony Show.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He was allowed to stay at WNEW when we all got fired because he was never an official member of the show.
Right.
Yeah, they didn't fire him, which is weird. He had a lot to do with the program. I think they just didn't have a clue.
No, yeah. I think in the back of their minds they knew. They just didn't have a really good reason to get rid of me. Ooh, fire the commercial guy. Well, why?
How about you were associated with this program?
Well, I was waiting for a good year after that, and through all maybe two format changes at that point, I was waiting to get axed, and they never did it. So
yeah.
I was just, you know, I was lucky. I sort of, like, I was Teflon, never really moved. And my salary was so not, you know, minimal that it never really showed up on the radar. So, like, all right, you know.
Well, hey, they had peasants to pay Opie and I, so nobody else got any money. That's
exactly.
Sure.
Yeah, we're going to get into that a little bit later, I think. But we want to introduce everyone. But Steve has taken it to the limit on the road.
A few times. Just once or twice.
Every city we were at.
First of all, to get cut off in Boston.
He got cut off?
Yeah.
When was this?
You have to be so drunk.
You can remember.
You were cut off in Boston.
Oh, at the bowling alley.
No.
Well, no. At the bowling alley, you threw a bowling ball off the wall.
Into the wall and got yelled at.
Oh, that I remember, yeah.
And we all decided to go bowling.
Well, that's just because I'm a crappy bowler. That has nothing to do with being drunk. That's just I didn't know how to let go of the ball.
You hit the wall. How bad of a bowler are you?
You hit the wall. And it's a nice bowling alley. It's not one of these.
No, it was very nice. I was aware of that. I couldn't let go of the ball in time and sort of bounced.
As long as I don't have to comfort you anymore on a sidewalk.
No more of that. What a prick.
Oh, my goodness.
That's all I'm saying.
All right. I was having a bad night. It was a bad day, huh?
Yeah, but I don't know.
No more of that.
I'm only 160 pounds. I shouldn't be consoling. How much do you weigh?
Now 260.
I shouldn't be consoling 260-pound men.
No.
Ever. Never again.
ever.
Unless it's the privacy of your own bedroom.
No, never again. That was an isolated incident. Never again.
Wouldn't be as bad if you didn't have your pants pulled up to mid-waist with your shirt tucked in like some kind of a William Frawley creep.
What are you talking? Who are you looking at?
William Frawley.
It's just awful the way you just tuck your shirt in so nice and neatly. You have to stop that. Let it hang out. Live a little.
Well, I'm sorry. We can't all let it hang over let the gut hang over the pants.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, very good. All right.
Jesus. So back at him.
So Steve is an official member of the Opie and Anthony Show now.
Yeah.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer Steve Carlisi.
Remembering our old friend Steve Carlisi, this segment here, for those of you who are long-term listeners of the fans, as they would say, linger longer, Steve used to go by the nickname Martini Steve. It's not a nickname that he gave himself, but one that the show sort of just forced upon him. And like everything on this show, all it takes is one little thing to be said on the air, and you're labeled with that nickname for the rest of your term with the show, even when you leave the show. This is the origin of Martini Steve.
Get Steve in here, because he's so pissed off at some of the contestants. He wants to kick out girls that are so hot it's not even funny. It's not their fault that they were smart enough to figure crap out, okay?
Well, we've realized Steve does hate the listeners. He hates the people that listen to this program. He hates the people that go to his website.
He hates himself.
He's just a hater. He's a hater.
He hates his tiny little shot glass stomach.
Oh, he hates that little nutshell stomach.
I see if Foundry 4Lane can come in here.
Steve, now looking like Andrew Dice Clay from 4Lane.
Yeah, I went a little nuts.
Oh, did I say 4Lane?
4Lane.
Screwed up 5 times. I screwed up twice, but who's keeping track?
Foundry 4Lane. Oh, God, you did say that. I knew what you meant.
It's Martini Steve, everyone, who hates everyone.
Foundry 4Lane.
Including himself. There was one point, Steve and Scott were telling me in the back office, that they were both looking at the voting screen with their hands, you know, folded, all pissed off because they see the girls cheating.
Yeah.
They are watching them cheat. All the other girls would get a vote here like click, click, click. No big deal, you know?
Right.
Kind of a normal voting pattern, right? Mm-hmm. There were some girls, click, 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 getting hundreds of votes per minute.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it was a little bit
ridiculous.
You could
just see their vote totals going up by the hundreds.
Tally.
Cheating.
We thought they could handle this on their own.
Yeah.
We thought we could trust you guys.
We didn't think we had to be here every day looking in.
Don't make us get the nanny cam.
We'll get a nanny cam and keep it on you people when we're away. How are we supposed to trust you next time we go away? How are we supposed to trust leaving you alone like this?
Joel. So we're going to figure
it out. We trust you.
I think we're going to need another day to post the top 20, though. Okay.
They're cheating on voting, and they're driving the Porsche into the water.
No, they didn't drive it. The brake wasn't on.
Oh, they drove it there, and they weren't supposed to be driving it.
But then the brake wasn't on.
Right.
So it rolled back into the water.
His fault.
Vote. Better vote. Better vote.
All I know is Tangerine Dream was playing all over this place while we were gone.
Steve C. came sliding out in his underwear, playing air guitar.
I look good in underwear now.
Ugh, Martini Steve.
Martini Steve.
Can your little shot glass stomach handle the olive when you have a martini?
Like it draws a martini glass.
What a dick.
For us. With the little olive stuck in his olive stomach.
Tilted sideways.
Hello. It's like a buffet for you, an olive.
It is three olives, actually. Dirty martini with Kettle One vodka. Very, very good stuff.
You hate the listeners, right?
Why don't you admit it?
You hate the listeners. You hate the people that go to your website. You just hate all the people.
Most of them, yeah.
But
yeah,
it's okay because you hate yourself.
Yeah, so. I'm not a big fan of myself either.
I'm just
my hate is all-consuming. I'm not sitting here on a throne loving myself and hating everybody else.
If he would cover his entire body with a tattoo.
Yeah, self-loathing. I tattoo my flesh because I despise myself
just
so much.
Just change yourself in any way, shape, or form that is available.
You ever find yourself having an M&M and just binging?
No, I can't do sugar.
Might have been funnier if I didn't say M&M. Yeah, I didn't sleep at all.
Thank you, Martini Steve.
Martini Steve now.
Talking about the top 20 Canadian rock groups of all time. We'll let you guess the number one, but let's get through the mess here. That is the bottom half of the top 20. Mm-hmm. 15th place, the band Trooper.
Trooper.
What was their one
remember
hit?
Trooper.
Didn't they have a hit in the United States? No, who would know is Martini Steve. Might have to get Martini Steve.
Martini Steve. We need some, like, Dean Martin music for him when he comes in.
We can almost use the Austin Powers thing.
Some kind of, you think?
The walk-on music.
Yeah. Martini Steve. Dancing down the hallway.
Dancing his way from one studio to the other.
With this martini glass.
Old change purse belly.
Those little rubber ones with the slit in it. Just a little, just enough for four quarters.
Martini Steve's now walking down the hall.
Where's Martini Steve?
Here he comes, Anthony. Let's get the music.
Can you sashay in?
Yeah.
Oh, wait, he just made a detour into the bathroom.
Where'd he go?
Lunch.
Did he have to throw up lunch?
Here he comes.
Yeah, Martini Steve. Martini Steve.
Steve?
Yeah, what's up?
We're doing the top 20 Canadian rock groups of all time, and in 15th place is the band Trooper, and we need to know what their U.S. hit was.
Trooper.
Trooper?
I think, crap.
Do you know?
No, I don't. I don't even know.
All right, thank you, Steve.
You're welcome. Thank you.
There goes Steve back to his studio, Anthony.
Trooper.
There goes Steve
back
to his studio.
There you go.
Martini Steve. We're reinventing his character live on our show.
Can't have the same old characters.
I'm,
You like looking at people's cards, Martini Steve? Yes.
What do we just take the same people and give them new names?
Well, that's what wrestling does. That's what we do here.
It's
now Martini Steve.
It's Martini Steve. Martini Steve. It's Martini Steve.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers Steve C.
Hey, what's up? It's Garrett. It's Stinky. Worked with Steve during the WNEW days, and what I'll remember about Steve is he was like the best friend of the show. No matter who was working on the show, you could always go to Steve with your problems, and he was always there. And he was always there just helping out the show, filming everything, putting up on the website, making production. He was just, his whole life was about the show, and it showed, and he was awesome at what he did, and he's going to be missed. So, I'll miss you, Steve. See you later.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer Steve Carlisi.
Remembering our good friend Steve Carlisi in this segment here, Steve was known best for his production. He came up with some really insane, idiotic stuff. And some things that just made you laugh for no reason other than Steve was out of his fucking mind. In this segment here, we explore Ramon. Ramon was one of the first creations that Steve came up with when we joined XM Satellite Radio. Steve was trying to go a little bit outside of the box of typical radio production and tried to come up with some clever, unique things that would really stand out. This happens to be one of them that a lot of people still remember to this day. This is the story of Ramon. And immediately following right after that is a montage of all the Ramon production that Steve did. And I hope you enjoy this as much as Steve did. Spent countless hours giggling and laughing to himself in a room with no windows, putting all this together for his own enjoyment. Here is Ramon.
What's up with you and your imaginary friend, Ramon?
He's not my imaginary friend. He's just the...
Did you make him up?
Yeah, I did.
Okay. He's yours.
He's my creation. I'll certainly take credit for that. But Ramon is the byproduct of something I learned when I was working at NEW. They told me that the a lot of the deep voice guys that do voiceover for movies and for for TV.
God.
Check this out. Listen, this is
explanation.
No, this I know, here's the explanation. This is exactly where it came from. They do a lot of their voiceover work from home in a home studio on ISDN lines. So a lot of them are just traipsing around home in their bathrobes or sweatpants. Making millions of dollars, mind you, doing voice work.
So and you believe there's some guy walking around and his houseboy is there.
And he has a houseboy.
And as he's doing these voiceovers, sometimes things happen and he's got to go, Ramon.
Exactly.
Clean himself.
So you feel like you're one of these big voice guys and you need a little houseboy.
Oh, no. That's why I pitch my voice down, because I have to make it sound like it's not me. So,
right.
So, yeah, exactly.
So not only does he have an imaginary friend named Ramon, he has an imaginary him.
Oh, this is not going well.
Did you just call from Jersey 2 minutes ago?
You think way too much into this. No,
this is how you be. I sit in a room with no windows, mind you, for hours on end. So
what's
sometimes you're...
What's the profile of Ramon? What kind of person is he?
Well, that's interesting.
Is he short,
Because I brought this up with Nathaniel and Danny yesterday, and they each have a different visualization for what Ramon looks like.
Really?
All right, get those guys in here.
Danny said I think he looked something like the other intern. But then Nathaniel had a totally different look for what Ramon might have looked like.
Is Ramon with you right now?
No, Ramon is not in the room.
Can you channel Ramon?
No, because you'll never hear from Ramon. You'll only hear Ramon being referenced.
You do hear from Ramon. Steve's not here right now, Mrs. Torrance. Ramon is the little boy who lives in my mouth.
Is Ramon your Jenny Piccolo? It's a friend that we'll just never see. It was Jimmy Piccolo, right, from Happy Days?
Yeah.
Ramon will, kind of. Ramon will never be referenced in the first person. You'll never hear, a little voice pop up and go, yes, sir. You'll never hear that. You will only hear Ramon being referenced as he's being addressed or in the third person.
His name.
Do you want him to talk, but, he's not supposed to?
No, it's been.
You like ice cream, Ramon?
Do you want to secretly be Ramon?
Oh, no. Ramon's a houseboy.
Yeah.
Ramon's a house. You don't aspire to be Ramon.
I'm thinking you might want to be a houseboy.
No.
Kind of like where someone tells you what to do.
I'll bet you in his mind, Ramon is probably 5'10", very svelte, smooth abs, unclipped, hung 10, fat, doesn't speak English, willing to do anything for a buck. Is that who Ramon is?
Ramon.
How many Ramon promos are there?
Honestly, I'm thinking there could be a series of Ramon.
Of course there will be.
When do you think maybe we should take Ramon to the doctor?
All right, if Derek's ready, let's hear the Ramon promo, Anthony.
All right.
Welcome to the Opie and Anthony. Ooh, it's in my shoes. Ramon, clean this up.
It's a little weird, Steve.
Of course it is.
Now your houseboy's got to clean the crap out of your shoes.
Do you pay him well, at least?
No, houseboys generally don't get paid well.
He's not making a lot of money?
No, I mean, let's say maybe he's Guatemalan. Maybe he's, uneducated.
Great production for the radio show, but I got to tell you, it's a little weird.
The Ramon thing.
Why does Ramon have to do everything for you?
Because, it's not me, but Ramon is a houseboy assigned to the menial tasks that this deep voice guy does not feel that he's...
I have a problem. Why is Ramon with you?
Yeah. Say there's a menial task that has to be taken care of.
Roadhead.
Yeah, exactly. Your mule is dirty, needs to be cleaned.
Ramon,
lap this up. Perfect example. You go to a self-serve gas station. Do you think this guy, this wealthy voiceover artist is going to be...
Ramon, top off my tank.
Yeah.
Right.
Exactly.
You're a couple weeks away from coming in here with a scarf.
I'm thinking that this guy has, almost the Heff outfit, not a leisure suit. What's it called? An ascot and a smoking jacket. Thank you.
Now, how does Ramon feel? Is Ramon
doesn't matter how
angry
Ramon feels.
At the guy?
Ramon could be angry. He might be bitter. He might be bitter.
He's crazy, by the way. Crazy Steve.
You have thought about this way too long. There's a profile on your imaginary friend Ramon.
Yeah. Yeah,
behind his back, does he like...
Or the person that you're voicing in these spots?
Yeah,
that's not Ramon. Obviously, is he married?
No. Actually, you know what? now that I think of it, there are two of the little cartoons on the website are pretty representative of what this deep voice guy and Ramon might look like. And Ramon is Ramon is a very short. Or potentially very short pygmy. I don't want to alter it too much.
Wow.
Because I don't want to alter it.
Let people imagine their own Ramon.
Ramon should be, everyone should have their own Ramon.
Should people start sending in maybe drawings and cartoons of what they think you and Ramon are?
I think that's a great idea.
Are like and look like.
Because there's some talented artists out
there. Has Ramon ever stood there and just thrown firecrackers while other people were preparing to rob the house?
Boogie night.
He's right.
Yeah. Ramon, that is a typical Ramon.
Yeah.
Yeah,
the guy throwing the firecrackers around the house.
All right,
that's a Ramon. Ramon takes care of the menial tasks that you can't be bothered with because, you're off making the money and you can pay somebody, $3 an hour to go and clean up diarrhea.
Really, for a casual thing, you have his salary already worked out.
Yeah.
How much does he make? Does he live for free in what do they call it, that other house?
Servants' quarters.
Pool house?
Like the pool house or something?
Yeah, he could potentially. You got to remember, he maybe doesn't have a great grasp of the English language.
Uh-huh.
He's from Central America. Uneducated.
And no grasp of U.S. law. as well.
I didn't say he was underage. I didn't say he was.
Oh no, no.
I didn't say he was underage.
We weren't saying that.
It's a deep voice guy with an a little helper named Ramon.
Sure.
Jesus.
Yeah.
No, that's
Danny.
You got like a guy with a pith helmet, yeah. Like an old
exactly.
An old adventurer.
Yeah.
With the optic thing.
Yeah,
he's got a monocle and a pith helmet and binoculars.
Mm-hmm. His name is actually Colonel Wetpants. But,
Colonel with like the the little handlebar mustache thing going like, well, there I was.
Yeah, exactly.
In Africa, elephant hunting, yes. When all of a sudden Ramon came over. And then Ramon is a black guy. And he's a pygmy with a bone through his nose and in his hair. With a big afro and like bracelets of bone.
Almost like a shorter LeVar Burton type.
So Ramon's not black. No, I don't see Ramon as being black.
No, I mean, but that's, you know,
I see Ramon as Central American, maybe even Mexican.
Hairless. I see Ramon as hairless.
See, you know, there's now we've got a completely different representation of Ramon. Than
you see a very hairy Ramon.
Of course you do, Steve.
Steve, really?
A mini bear.
No,
all Ramon can say in English is sweet and cozy. Cozy face.
All right, well, thank you, Steve. We just, sure. Anthony and I just noticed this whole Ramon thing that was kind of taking on a life of its own, and we had to kind of...
I thought you guys liked the Ramon things.
We do.
Oh, okay.
And all now right. They're even better now that we have the backstory. Are you kidding me?
Of course. Oh, okay, cool.
Who's not going to be paying attention to the Ramon promos, and everyone's going to be looking forward to the next one in the series?
Okie dokie.
Ramon. Golfing is a wonderful way to spend an afternoon. A true test of dexterity, skill, and, seems to have landed in some dog mess. Oh, not again. Ramon, wash my balls. Sweet oral pleasure. Such a talented little heroin addict. Oh, dear. Overdose. Ramon. Get the wood chipper. There is nothing quite like a Cuban cigar. Right, Ramon? The rich texture, the full flavor, so relaxing. Oh, fiddlesticks. No ashtray. Ramon, open your mouth. Ah, an exquisite day for mailbox baseball. Oof. Need a mint. Oh my, Ramon. Scoop up these puppy guts. And now, another holiday reading from Charles Dickens' immortal classic, A Christmas Carol. When Scrooge awoke, it was so dark that looking out of bed he could see meddling carolers every bloody year. Humbug. Ramon, fetch the nail gun. State of the Union. Gas prices going up again. The Opie and Anthony Show on XM. Hoop goes the weasel. Ramon, give me your sleeve. Food. Doesn't love a nice dip in the tranquil blue ocean. Oh, that looks like a dorsal fin. Carcharodon carcharias, if I'm not mistaken. One moment. Ramon, open your veins. Trekking through the Himalayas is quite exhausting. But the views are breathtaking. So tired. So famished. Great Scott, my Sherpa has collapsed. Ramon, fillet this Chinaman. I just love a drive in the country, laughing with Opie and Anthony. That plane is flying awfully low, don't you think, Ramon? Call 911. one. This local tavern appears to be quite festive. It's a friendly bunch in here. Seems to be mustache night. Perhaps I'll belly up to the old bar and request a libation. Ramon, fetch me a bikini teeny and then push in my stool. Welcome to the Opie and Anthony. Ooh, it's in my shoes. Ramon, clean this up.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer, Steve Carlisi.
Hello, it's Jeremy Coleman. I was the program director of WNEW back in the Opie and Anthony years. And there was this guy, Steve Carlisi. And I remember we hired Steve to do a sort of pretty entry-level job. He was supposed to come in, and he was supposed to dub commercials so that we could play commercials on the radio. And he was good at it, but then, whenever Opie and Anthony were on the air, he would stop. You could not get a commercial produced to save your life while Opie and Anthony were on, because he was working on his website for them with Foundry Music. He was paying attention to every single second of the show. You could not find a guy more dedicated to what was happening on the Opie and Anthony show. And I think things worked out rather well for Steve in that regard, and he ended up working with the show. And he was a great pleasure to work with, this big motorcycle rider kind of looking guy who is the sweetest guy you'd ever meet once you got to know him. And so it's incredibly sad to hear what happened, and my feelings go out to his family and everyone who knew Steve. But I am grateful that there are some great memories of Steve Carlisi in this world, and we'll hold on to those.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer, Steve Carlisi.
And it is true. Steve C., who worked with the show for, I don't know, at least 10 years, died. And I'm sick about it. Steve left behind a 2-year-old, a wife, and a stepdaughter who's 16 or 17, I believe. To donate to Steve's family, tinyurl.com/Steve C Fund. If you can give, great. If you can't, don't worry about it. We understand. It's tinyurl.com/Steve C Fund.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers Steve C.
Thank you for joining us. My name is E-Rock, and we're remembering the life and times of Steve Carlisi, Steve C, here on The Opie and Anthony Show. In this segment here, we're going to take a look at Steve's acting and improv skills, both of which the hosts of this show thought were lackluster or non-existent. In the first segment, Steve's acting ability is portrayed in a production piece that he did with a former intern, Wild Bill, which led to such memorable drops as "Get the fuck out," "What are you doing in my house?" and "That's terrible, I'm sorry." Plus a whole lot more. And then follow that up with a bit about Steve's improv skills, which Jim just thinks are total shit. Here it is.
All right. Do you want to hear Steve's awful acting, Jimmy?
Yes, I do.
Oh, who doesn't?
Will this wake you up a little bit?
Oh, yeah.
Are they watching him sleep on Pal Talk?
I'm tired.
Yeah.
Yeah, he should be on there.
All right. This is from Wild Bill Productions, Bill the Intern. We weren't even going to play this, but then we noticed...
Bill's a boob.
Then we noticed that Steve's acting is horrific, and now it's just become part of Opie and Anthony folklore.
The Opie and Anthony Show presents a Wild Bill production.
Due to the massive critical acclaim and commercial success of the Ben and Sam Show, XM202 is proud to present a new Opie and Anthony spinoff, a program that will surely take the radio world by storm, announcing Steve C. and his best friend Bill, starring Opie and Anthony's own Steve C. and his best friend forever, Bill the Intern, who is sensible, articulate, and certainly not crazy.
Hello, anyone home? Hello? Hiya, Steve. Well, condo.
What are you doing in my house?
Why are you pissed off? What's your fucking problem?
What's my problem? You're in my fucking house.
All right, listen. This is so good.
Oh, sing-song jizzbag.
It gets better every
What's
time you hear
it. What's my problem? You're in my fucking house.
By the way, Bill's acting is very believable as the psycho.
Bill's kind of good as the psychopath.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
He's like, stealing the scene.
He can't quite get the words. He's spinning. He's like, fucking. He's like a drunk lunatic, which is what he is.
Let's go back.
Not really a stretch.
Anyone home? Hello? Hiya, Steve. Swell condo.
What are you doing in my house?
Why are you pissed off? What's your fucking problem?
What's my problem? You're in my fucking house.
The door was open. I thought your wife was going to cook us a nice organic dinner.
Honey, is there a problem?
No.
nothing's wrong, just stay in the living room. I'll handle it. Bill, get the fuck out now.
I can't leave.
Why not?
My parents just died, and you're my legal guardian.
That's terrible. I'm sorry. How'd your parents die?
In their sleep?
Bill again!
Bill? Bill is fucking crazy.
Yeah.
The concept for that is just like the ramblings of a mad person. What is it? In their sleep? And then the Gilligan's Island music and
what was Steve's other line? It was, that's terrible.
That's terrible. I'm sorry.
How do they die?
That's terrible.
I'm sorry.
My favorite part is the sing song. You're in my fucking house. That and the stay inside.
I'll handle this.
He's just got. He's a flatlining idiot.
Oh,
there's a criminal there. Just stay inside.
Stay inside.
What are you having pillow talk, shithead?
Honey, just stay inside.
We'll go right to the. We'll go right to the acting here.
Not crazy.
Hello, anyone home? Hello. Hiya, Steve. Swell condo.
What are you doing in my house?
Why are you pissed off? What's your fucking problem?
What's my problem? You're in my fucking house.
The door was open. I thought your wife was gonna cook us a nice organic dinner.
Honey, is there a problem?
No, nothing's wrong. Just stay in the living room. I'll handle it.
How calm is that?
Get the fuck out now.
I can't leave.
Why not?
My parents just died, and you're my legal guardian.
That's terrible. I'm sorry. How'd your parents die?
In their sleep?
Bill again!
That is so good.
I could listen to that all day. Steve is awful.
Keep that close.
Everybody goes, I'll handle it.
I'll handle it.
There's a criminal in his house. I'll handle it.
I'll handle it.
What's my motivation? To put everyone to sleep. Okay.
You're in my fucking house.
That's terrible. I'm sorry.
That's terrible. I'm sorry.
It just stinks.
Steve sucks.
That acting was just DOA.
Mm-hmm. I just want to yell. I'll handle it.
I'll handle it.
And you know,
stay inside.
Steve talks with his hands upside down, pointed upwards, almost like he's picture someone carrying a Yule log with no log in their hands.
Right.
That's how his hands are always, and he kind of shuffles them back and forth dumbly. And you know that's how he was actually doing it? That's terrible. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. Look,
like he's fondling breasts.
Yeah, like he's got two big balls, one in each hand.
That's terrible. I'm sorry.
You're in my fucking house. I'll handle it.
They couldn't have gotten through that in one take. Are there outtakes?
Oh, please tell
Come
me.
Come on.
Please tell me there's outtakes.
There's got to be outtakes. Go through that folder.
All right. Dirk's going to look later.
Make sure he doesn't delete them.
All right.
Bastard.
We'll take another break. We'll get
You're in my fucking house. No, no. Let's do it again.
You're
in my fucking house. No, no. Okay, one more time. You're in my fucking house. No, no.
That was the best version they had.
That was the best takes.
I like this one because there's a little stutter, and that's terrible. It
sounds so natural.
This is how he reacts to the parents died in the garden. My parents died. This is his reaction.
That's terrible. I'm sorry.
Wow. Way to show some feeling.
I love how bad that is.
He should be doing Shakespeare in the rest area. That's terrible. I'm sorry. Why don't you shut up?
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers Steve C.
Roll in the Steve Car
Carlisi's School of Improv. Here's one of my students now.
Give me a person, an occupation, and a situation. Okay, a fireman, a firehouse, and a fire.
Yes, I think there's been a fire at somebody's house.
This kid's a genius. He's my best student.
All right, we're going to pick an object, a comb.
It's a comb. My hair must be messy.
Oh, my God. I'm in tears over here. Someone in the audience, pick an occupation.
Producer.
I have no idea what that is.
How's that for improv?
When in doubt, open your eyes wide and panic. Roll in the Steve Carlisi School of Improv. Yes, I get it. I have no improv skills.
That's good, Derek. That's Derek.
Oh, damn. The guy that talks bad about us behind our backs?
Yes.
Yeah, let him go.
Let him go, you know.
Let him go.
Who doesn't? All right. And now Steve is a ballerina today. That's wonderful.
I'm a ballerina.
Mm. That's right.
I'm a ballerina in training.
Roland, you like Steve?
I do.
I'm also a little teapot, short and stout.
That's right. Here is my handle, and here is my gout. or there is the closet. I should step out. Don't criticize Foundry, or I'll pout.
My producer skills are in doubt.
That's right. I came in my pants. I better use some shout. In the world of radio, I have no clout.
A sun pendulum. What's it about?
That pendulum album stunk worse than trout.
poor Stevie.
Yeah.
I'm fighting obesity and losing the bout.
That's not very sweet.
Let it be known, no one is tickling Roland. I'm a little teapot.
Short and stout. Here is my handle. Here is my spout.
That's right. Put a finger in my backside and cum shoots out. Wow.
Yeah. Steve's good. He's a good
friend. Of course he is. What is he talking about?
Who knows?
I hear like
Steve, what are you doing?
Chatter.
Yeah. Probably diesel trucks his calves have been compared to. And they thought one time it was a I get it, Jim. Right.
Oh. So,
wheels came off.
Oh, the wheels on the bus go round and round.
I don't know why I'm singing children's songs now.
Because it was fun. That little teapot. Because you can picture Steve doing that while dressed in like a fucking a one color latex outfit. Like a beige latex outfit. Except for the black right arm, because that's the handle part of the teapot.
Yes. And I'm short and stout. And there's my handle. I want it to be a handle.
That's right.
Come shoot.
Oh, boy.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers Steve C.
Hey, this is John, formerly the WNEW dump guy who used to work with Steve back in the NEW days with ONA. And the thing I probably remember the most and was one of the most fun times I ever had in radio was Steve and I used to write little sort of 60-second bits for the show. And the fun thing was just I used to think of these ideas on the bus, and I used to couldn't wait until I got into the station to run into Steve's studio and say, I got this great, amazing idea. And he would actually appreciate that I had this idea. And the two of us would just sit there and just come up with all these crazy things based on audio from the show. And we were just cranking them out one after the other, one after the other after the other. And it just became the most fun I've had doing radio. And because of that, Steve and I became really closer friends. We were friends before that, but we became really close friends because of that. And that's what I was thinking of most when I heard about Steve was I just wish I could run into a studio and just write stuff with him again. So Steve is my friend, and I miss him. I still miss him, and I think about him every day.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers Steve C.
Yes, remembering our good friend Steve Carlisi in this segment, we've been analyzing his acting and improv skills. Well, this upcoming bit here involves actor Brian Cox, who's in studio. And we bring up the fact that, you know, Steve's an up-and-coming actor. He's trying to make it into the big time. So they ask Brian Cox if he has any advice or direction for Steve as far as achieving an acting career. Brian Cox doesn't think so. Here it is.
Somebody was singing your praises and saying, you know, it was the gentleman with the green arms who met me at the door.
Oh, this creepy Steve, we call
him? Yeah, he said that you did a video game together and that you were a wonderful actor. He said, he's a really good actor. I'm not an actor at all. Apparently, he was in it as well.
That was very nice of you to relay, but here's what stupid Steve just did. Let me catch that bastard. He just wanted you to know that he did something, and he couldn't be so obnoxious as to go, do you know I did a video game? Would you please tell me what you think?
I did voiceover.
So he had to make it look like he was giving me a compliment.
Well, he was giving you a compliment.
It certainly is with your creepy green arms. Brian doesn't like it, and neither do we.
I didn't say that.
Well, you didn't have to. Oh, the first thing he said this morning when I gave him the game was, I've got to go to IMDb and make sure that it's there already.
Yeah, he wants his credit on IMDb.
Look, if I'm going to get... Is this on? If I'm going to get pummeled, you know, mercilessly, I'm going to make sure it's up on IMDb.
Yeah, go to Brian's IMDb site and then look at a real actor's site before you look at your one credit for a voiceover on a video game.
RAM.
Believe me, I'm not deluding myself at all.
Well,
yes,
you know
what? Actor, I'm not.
Don't sell yourself short. Do we have? There's a couple of Steve did a sketch. We have audio of. Do we have a couple just lines? We have like little lines from Steve. And if you want to see somebody emote, I mean, this kid is good.
Well, yeah, give the setup too for Brian.
It was a sketch where Steve. Steve, you want to explain the sketch to Mr. Scott?
No, not really.
It was one of our interns, Bill, played a weird guy who walks into Steve's house. And it's a bizarre sketch. And Steve just has such emotion. And it turns out that in the sketch, Bill's parents have died. So Bill, Steve has to ask Bill, how did your parents
how
die?
Did
there's
your
just
parents
a lot
die?
Of emotion in it.
And then there's another part where he says, why not? Now listen to the emotion, the difference, the dynamic between how did your parents die and just... an ordinary why not grabbed randomly from his lines. Here's why not.
Why not? How'd your parents die? Why not? How'd your parents die? Why not? How'd your parents die?
Do you detect the emotion in the parents dying part?
Well, maybe that's... Is it good as an actor to just kind of like say everything the same and figure that the audience can put in the pauses where they feel it's necessary?
Or the emotion, or the dynamic, or anything.
Steve is like Mad Libs with emotion. Like, he'll throw out the lines and then let the audience fill in however they feel about it.
Well, it's a very difficult thing to I can't really tell from just hearing those two lines.
Oh, yes, you can, because that's it. That's his range.
Wait,
it seems to me it sounded real. sometimes that's the best
the
you can
views
get,
are in.
You know. I mean, the thing about the
Brian
thing about,
Cox, it sounded real.
He'll put that on his bio.
He'll put it on his bio as a credit. The quotes around.
Can I hear it again?
Yeah, here he goes.
Why not? How'd your parents die? Why not? How'd your parents die?
Well, there was a genuine intention there. You could hear the intention was that he really wanted to know how their parents died. So, in fact, he succeeded quite well. I don't think that's bad at all. And also, he didn't let emotion get in the way.
Right.
Well, what I want to know is, what does the why not relate to? I don't get the why not in the doesn't really relate to how why
what
did
was why not again?
Was it that Bill wanted to come in, and he said, can I come in? And you said, why not?
Yeah.
It was... I can't go home, and he couldn't.
Oh,
go back.
He can't go home, and then he said, "Why not?" And he goes, "My parents died."
And then Steve, we have a response. Steve goes, "How'd your parents die?" But when Bill says, "My parents died," Steve has a response to that,
which is just
thick with compassion and emotion.
Yes,
beautiful.
Some more, Steve.
That's terrible. I'm sorry.
He has a little stutter, a stammer thing.
That's terrible. I'm sorry.
Yeah, you're embarrassed, which is fine. I can see that, and that's a kind of genuine emotion. This gentleman's parents have died, and you're embarrassed that they've died. And you're saying, hear it again?
Yes, of course, sir.
That's terrible. I'm sorry.
So you're saying, that's terrible. I'm sorry. That's terrible. I'm sorry. That's terrible. I'm sorry. That's
emotion.
Terrible. I'm sorry. And it's like, I want to get out of the room because it's terrible and I'm sorry. So I actually think you do it quite well. I'm actually rather impressed.
Wow. Well, thank you, sir.
Brian just took horse manure and made lemonade.
But you know, half the thing with all of this, I mean, I've just done this movie called Running with Scissors.
Yeah.
And the thing is, the material is so extraordinary. You don't have to do anything. You just sit back on it and let it ride you rather than try and write it, because there's no way you could ever match it. Because
I'm looking forward to the movie. I've read the book.
Yeah, it's a good movie.
It's a crazy story. Are you playing the psychiatrist?
I play Finch. Yeah, I play the doctor. Yeah.
The doctor. Yeah.
Yeah, and the psychiatrist.
He adopts.
I adopt Augustine Burroughs.
Yeah. Right.
And it's a really good story. I mean, people have been going on about the veracity of it, the truth. Sorry, I don't want to use big
That's
words.
Okay. Yeah. Steve's still in the
sorry,
room.
Sorry, Steve. My apologies.
I'm sorry. I don't understand that.
That's okay, I'm sorry.
Terrible.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer, Steve Carlisi.
Continuing on with analyzing Steve's acting and improv skills, you just heard from Brian Cox. And in this upcoming bit here, we have Tobin Bell and Shawnee Smith. They're in promoting, I think, one of the Saw movies. And of course, it's brought up again that Steve's trying to be an actor, and maybe these guys, who are professionals at their craft, have worked hard for many, many years, and make very good money doing so. Does Steve have the chops to join their ranks? Who knows, as Tobin Bell and Shawnee Smith judge the acting abilities of Steve C.
We have an actor among us.
You do?
Yeah, we have a few, actually.
Raise your hands if you're an actor. Jeez, we got to...
We're not going to raise our hands.
Nobody raised their hand.
Well,
I've done it, but it's... You can't be with two real actors.
me too. I'm an actor too.
I was a store clerk in a Opie and Anthony TV commercial. That's just somewhere. Like your career, sir.
Yeah. I played a few store clerks.
Yeah.
You know.
And do we have some examples of Steve's acting?
This is Steve.
Steve, here's our actor right here.
Yeah.
Hey, Steve. Oh, Steve. Hey, yeah.
Here's Steve.
Yeah, exactly.
Steve's looking happy to be in here right now.
I recognize you.
Oh, come on, Steve. You're good.
Where's the rest of the Steve?
What?
Where's the rest of the Steve? We got this one.
That's terrible. I'm sorry.
Huh? Oh, there it is. Here's Steve. Here's Steve delivering his lines. Now, listen, one line he had to deliver was...
Steve, you look nervous.
No, not nervous. Just it's when the bus tire actually rolls onto your chest, just have to sort of go limp.
He had to ask how someone's parents died. And in another scene, it was just him saying, why not? So we took those two, and you know how much emotion would have to go into asking someone how their parents died? And then just why not as a throwaway line. Listen to the difference, dynamic.
Before you play that, though, I was wondering maybe if Tobin could, like, do the line. And then we'll show Tobin how Steve did it. Is that okay with you?
Absolutely. I'd like to.
All right, give him his motivation and then the line he has to
and
say.
Then I'll review you both.
Yeah.
Oh, great.
Great. Just a throwaway, like... you don't really care. Somebody may ask you to go somewhere. You don't really care. You just go, why not? You know, why not? That's it.
Why not?
There you go. Why not?
Why not?
Yeah. See, you get a couple of different variations from him, too,
right.
Steve.
Right. This is what Steve does.
And now this one, the line is, had your parents die. Now, you would think that's How'd your parents die? You'd think it's a very emotional thing. You'd want a little sympathy, a little curiosity to it and stuff. And Steve delivered it perfectly. But I'd like to see how a real actor would deliver
go ahead,
that.
Tobin.
How'd your parents die?
Do I have to have the contraction in there, the how'd? Or can I say
however you want to do it.
You can make sure.
Yeah, you do have
you sure want to have a meeting about it. You know,
you're the professional.
Have a meeting about these kind of things.
Yeah, right?
And action.
How did your parents die?
Wow.
Well, see?
Wow. That was
Steve.
Wow.
That was good, eh?
All right. Now,
Here is the dynamic.
That was the good question about the contraction, though, because he knew what he wanted to do.
He knew. Yeah.
Perfect.
Perfect. Here is Steve delivering those two lines. Why not? Had your parents die. Listen to the dynamic difference in both of them.
Why not? Had your parents die. Why not?
Wait, wait, hold on.
Had your parents die.
Wait, the bus is backing up.
Evidently.
Why not? Had your parents die.
It wasn't quite
Why not?
As poignant as
Had your parents die. Why not? Had your parents die.
Oh,
he's got a lot of range. He's got a lot of range.
Slightly different, Tobin. Slightly different.
Versatility of a rake. You stink.
Yes, I do.
Shawnee, you started so young. How did you get into acting? What did you do? Commercials?
Commercials.
Yeah.
There was a girl on the street who did the Northern toilet paper.
Toilet paper?
You did a toilet paper commercial?
No, the girl at the street did.
Bitch.
And unfortunately, we went for walks around the block. My mom talked to her mom, got my mom's panties all in a bunch about, you know, my daughter could do that. So she, next thing I know, she's got me out with the camera taking pictures and send it to the agency. And then I'm on a McDonald's commercial.
Yeah, you make it sound so easy.
Yeah.
And then you were like, just, you know, kind of watched you grow up every so often. It's like, hey, there she is.
Yeah.
I remember her from that last movie. She was a little younger in the last movie.
Have you been stalking her?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, a little creepy.
Absolutely. Absolutely. She's one of my faves. Yeah. She pops up in movies all the time.
Overnight success with the Saw movies.
Yeah. Very cool.
After 2 decades.
Oh, please.
Love it.
I'm sure people are constantly like, you get recognized a lot, don't you?
Not a lot.
Really?
Not a lot. People recognize me more when they hear me speak than looking at me.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I don't always have this.
Different color hair. Yeah.
You know.
Just all rocked out today.
Yeah. Yeah. I glammed up for you guys.
Glammed.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
I heard you were edgy.
Yeah.
I think we have to get them out of here.
Edgy.
They're telling us you had a...
Yeah. We just saw you on TV. I don't know the talk.
Where are you going next, you guys?
I have no idea.
Neither do I.
They just cart you around.
It's too overwhelming to look at the big picture. Yeah.
How did your parents die?
Oh, is that good, man?
It really is.
Wow.
I can't believe it when he
says that. That's the way it's delivered, you dork.
I'll tell you how Steve's parents died. They shot themselves after they heard his performance.
Yes, they did. Steve,
yeah,
keep it up.
Keep it up, baby. Don't let you intimidate you.
Don't let the critics bring you down.
Oh, I never will.
You know why, Steve? Because they don't know.
That's right.
Okay, that's right.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer Steve Carlisi.
Hello, everyone. This is Earl. Longtime O&A fans know me as Black Earl. And I'm. This is hard. I'm not gonna mince words about it. I worked with Steve at NEW when I was there. I was there for many years, and he came aboard first as kind of the web guy. He ran all the video. He posted all the video on foundrymusic.com of some of the better O&A bits that happened. Some of the most incredible things you had ever experience on the radio. And then we worked together as and when I was there as a promotions guy and also as a producer, and then he came aboard as the production guy. He handled all of the O&A production, basically all the station production after a while, and got to know him pretty well. We had a lot of talks. I mean, one of the things that was great about Steve was that he was funny. He was really funny. He had this like really twisted sense of humor that I loved. But he was also very honest. He was honest to the point of brutal, but you respected it because you want honesty from people. You want to know where people stand. And Steve, there was no middle ground. You knew where you stood with Steve. And we had so many laughs in his studio. He would play me something or we would talk about things. You know, in recent years, we would talk about other things, you know, talk about the business, talk about this, talk about that. And it was always warm. It was always fun. It was always remarkable. The last conversation I had with him was about family. You know, he was so happy to be a father. And when I got the news, that's just the first thing that really hit me hard was that his son, you know, wasn't gonna have his dad. You know, and my heart goes out to his wife and his stepdaughter, and of course his son. And I'm going to miss just those crazy days, just kind of hanging, talking, laughing. A lot of laughs with Steve. He's just this big bear of a guy. I mean, he had, his nickname was Steve the Bear, but, and it fit. And it fit. He was a bear, but I mean, underneath that gruff exterior was a really warm, sweet guy. And I'm going to miss him. I mean, I'm still processing it. I'm still kind of like trying to figure out what happened. And I still can't believe he's gone. And Steve, I'm going to miss you. I love you, brother. Love.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer Steve Carlisi.
And it is true. Steve C., who worked with this show for, I don't know, at least 10 years, died. And I'm sick about it. Steve left behind a 2-year-old, a wife, and a stepdaughter who's 16 or 17, I believe. To donate to Steve's family, tinyurl.com/Steve C. Fund. If you can give, great. If you can't, don't worry about it. We understand. It's tinyurl.com/Steve C. Fund.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers Steve C.
Hey, this is Roland. I booked a talent for the Opie and Anthony Show. And it's terrible what happened to Steve of his passing. It's very sad. I first met Steve when I first started booking for the show when they went to XM Radio. I remember the first day when I met him. Yeah, I met him and Master Poe were my first two interactions ever with the show. And Steve sort of took me under his wing to introduce me to everybody. And we built our friendship from there. It was like the last, I can't talk. The last week when XM and Sirius merged, I was leaving the guys for a little bit. And Steve was sad, and we would always talk back and forth, did lunch my whole last week on the show when they were at K-Rock and XM. And Steve wanted, he tried his hardest to get Springsteen on the phone and Carson Daly, my other old boss, on the phone to say the goodbyes and everything. And on my last day, Steve came up to me, goes, I couldn't get Bruce, I couldn't get Carson. I tried, I called everybody, I did this, I did that. And I started laughing. I had to tell him, I go, yeah, I know. I was text that you were trying to get hold of him. I said, Dad, just don't bother calling in. And Steve was like, oh, and all this time I spent. And he just laughed at it. And just, we always kept on contact. And then it just, I don't know, Steve was just a good guy. He always protected you. He's like the big brother that oversaw things and helped you and protected you. And it's just, I'm going to miss him. It's very sad, and I deepest sympathies to his wife and his kid. It just, I don't know. It's one of those things where you're just like, you almost don't believe it at first. And then once it sets in, it's just depressing. But all I can say is Steve was just a great guy, a great friend, and an amazing person.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer Steve Carlisi.
Yes, we're looking back at the memory of our fallen friend Steve Carlisi here. All his time spent on the Opie and Anthony Show, some of the most memorable and idiotic things that Steve has done on this program and said on this program. This one, this one's a doozy. It's I said doozy, but this one was a big one involving Corey Delaney. Now, who is Corey Delaney? Corey Delaney was this kid from Australia who decided to throw a big house party and publish it on MySpace at the time, where over 500 people showed up at this house and destroyed everything, to the extent that the cops had to come and wait for the party to burn out before they could clean up and arrest everybody and what have you. So we play a news piece from Australia where they're interviewing Corey, and he's a real sarcastic asshole, if you will. We enjoyed it. So we tried to get the guy on the phone. Steve did a little research, and lo and behold, we got the guy on the phone. Now, where this piece that you're going to hear picks up, we already played the audio, and we've already talked to Corey on the phone. This is the very next day where we find out, did we talk to the real Corey Delaney? Did Steve do a good job? I'll let you hear it for yourself. If you haven't heard it before, this is a classic moment in Steve C. history, and it's also the debut of a catchphrase that I won't give to you because people say I spoil things, but this is the big catchphrase for Steve Carlisi, other than yes, and I'm gay. Check it out right now.
Scroll to the wrong person. Hello, is this Australia? Is Corey there?
Is this Australia?
who would you like me? Corey, the man on the computer.
Corey, could you please connect me with him?
Oh, hello, this is Corey.
It's him. It sounds he's got an accent.
Hi, do you have an accent? Huh? Okay, good. Could you talk to Opie and Anthony?
Obviously, it's time for a beating.
Yes. It's Corey. I hear a didgeridoo. A didgeridoo.
All right.
Hey,
So it says here you're a kangaroo lassoer.
Hello, Australia. That's great.
Yes, I'm trying to call a continent.
Yes, his name is Corey. Do you have a last name? No, but he's the guy from the news clip.
The news. You've had to have seen it in Australia.
He has delicious, delicious nipple rings and a smooth chest.
Like me.
I don't know why I'm here. You guys are doing so well without me.
I know. It's just more fun when you're in the room. I don't know why.
So this is where we get dragged into the story. We got the kid on the phone yesterday that threw the party. We just played his audio, obviously. And now it looks like it wasn't the kid.
Right.
According to everyone.
Or at least according to everybody, yeah.
Oh, it's now everybody that, now?
Well, no.
It's,
this does seem like it was a scam. Definitely.
Yeah, it seems like here's exactly what happened. The website that you guys plugged yesterday, like within 24 hours of the kid being on the show, is now redirecting to some other website that says, haha, gotcha.
Oh, you know. Shit.
Yeah, basically. It was...
Can we get the guy on and give him his props?
Well, wait a minute.
I'll call him. Uh-oh, I inadvertently got the real guy.
Yeah.
Travis had the guys correct MySpace. What's that about? What's up, Travis? What do you got on this?
Good evening. When Steve asks me to do something, I usually try and do it. And then... And then Steve will try and do it at the same time. And,
okay.
And wait a minute. He won't match notes with me before he bursts into my booth with a phone number.
Ooh.
I found the guy's fake MySpace, and Sam and I immediately knew that it was fake.
Because you've made so many fake MySpaces for people.
No, that's not true. Because, because he had, all of his pictures were just, screen caps of this kid that was on the news.
Oh, okay, yeah, any idiot would know that.
Yeah, and then I find his real MySpace 2 seconds later with, personal pictures of him and his email address. So I sent the guy an email, and 10 minutes later, Steve bursts into my booth saying, I found his MySpace and I've got his phone number, and... That's
And you were a wealth of information when there were six people trying to dial this guy on the phone yesterday?
Steve, it doesn't matter. I found the guy's real MySpace. You
well,
found the
no, the point. Yeah, I understand. I'm not saying I didn't get. I didn't get duped.
I did. I did a little research before.
I did the same thing you did, which is go online. You check Google. You Google the kid's name. Unfortunately, the one I wound up contacting was ranked higher than the one you wound up contacting, and that's why. And that was the first kid I got a response from. Anyway,
well, I look for
point is. Listen.
Wait, did you get the guy's email you back?
No, he never emailed. I think that's because he's in police custody.
Okay.
Yeah. He was actually in custody when we were talking, I think, to the people yesterday.
It's
12:30 in the a.m.
No, he was arrested after that, I think.
We got duped. So the world gets brainwaved. Is that a new term? Or just for the stupid website?
I think that's a blog.
Yeah.
Slug line.
It's safe to say John's surname and myself are probably the greatest humans alive.
That's a little pompous.
Yeah,
a little arrogant.
So this is the guy that duped us?
Yeah.
That guy really thinks you're the greatest person alive. Not a lot of humility there.
He said, it's safe to say John's surname and myself are probably the greatest humans alive.
Humans?
Are you crazy?
How about Jonas Salk?
You pulled a good
just
prank.
Throwing something out there. Sorry. No one gets the polio reference.
I got it.
Thank you.
That's hard to read there.
Who the
Thank
fuck knows what time it is in that... shit country.
Right. Anyone that has an iPhone.
Yeah.
Yeah, Yeah, you can just pop it right in there. Boom. Tells you what time it is.
The whole world cares. A big party with a bunch of fucking white kids running probably through a dirt street.
No yeah. one cares.
Berries in it.
And then...
Berries in it.
And then...
dead dingo on the side of the road. A fucking, wallaby. A
fucking elk taking shits in the driveway.
We get dragged in right here. Opie and Anthony get brainwaved.
Oh, boy, did we.
But then came the big time. So they were tricking everybody, but we were the big ones.
We're the big time.
We were the big fish.
It rocks.
We received an email from them at this point in time saying that they would like to do a live interview with Corey Delaney on their show, if he was willing. Only Corey wasn't there, just us and our stupid fake MySpace. At 12:23 a.m., after a few connection issues, John's surname appeared as the infamous Corey Delaney on the Opie and Anthony show.
But I felt that we did a good interview, even though it wasn't him.
Yeah.
Hey, maybe you can get Tim Manson on the phone and do a prison interview with him.
Well, how about everyone listen for themselves? So let's listen.
Oh, wait a minute. Well, we're getting an exclusive here on line two.
Oh, good.
That's good. Steve?
Yeah.
You want to take this call?
Absolutely.
Hello? Hello?
Yes, hello. Hello. Who's this?
Is this the Opie and Anthony show?
It absolutely is. Who's this?
This is Amelia Earhart.
Wow. Amelia Earhart missing Earhart. For so long.
Oh, yeah.
That's fantastic.
Cool. Go ahead and fuck up your own name, Amelia.
Well, it's been lost for a while.
Thank you for taking my call. I appreciate it. And please check out my web space. Punching out.
Well, you should have punched out, perhaps.
Nah, you did well. So let's listen to this. This is us talking to the fake Corey yesterday. Now it's interesting to listen to. Listen to the signs that maybe this guy wasn't real.
Hold on a minute. I got to take a phone call here.
Who's calling?
Hello.
Hello.
Hey. Hi. Who's this?
This is Elvis Presley, baby.
Oh, Steve, it sounds like him. What do you think?
I think it's him.
All right, Elvis.
I need you to get a hell of Priscilla for me, all right? Get her website for me, all right? All right. Tell her I'm alive.
All right, we'll go
punching
to your web.
Punching out.
Can I ask why we had a faker yesterday, but now why everyone's dead calling?
Yeah, well,
how does this translate to contacting the dead?
Because it's tough to stay in hiding these days. There's no other way to do this pitch, I mean, if you think about it.
And how did Elvis know to say punching out?
Yeah, he's been listening.
Hi, who's this?
This is D.B. Cooper.
D.B. Cooper. Wow.
D.B. Cooper.
Now, this one might be
I want to tell you where I am and where all my fortunes are.
Go ahead.
All right. Hey, Steve, can you take this phone call, please?
Absolutely.
Hello?
This is Osama bin Laden.
Oh, Jesus. Somebody get the FBI.
You're infidels. You have not found me yet.
Well,
I'm hiding.
You think this will make the news? I mean, we're talking with Osama bin Laden.
Yeah,
Steve.
Absolutely will. I'll cut it up and send it off to all the papers.
Send it off.
You think FARC will post our interview?
Osama bin Laden? Posted anything for a while.
Oh, you just fucked up all your connections.
I listen to the Opie and Anthony show all the time.
Thank you, Osama.
It's good, Osama, who sounds like a fucking Hindu.
Indian customer fucking service.
We look like assholes right now, man.
Yeah, we do.
More of the fake Corey interview.
We're going to check in with you, but the next time we try calling, you're not going to take our call. That happens all the time with us, with you internet stars.
Oh, no.
Remember,
just turn it off, E-Rock. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. You internet stars. Some kid in his fucking parents' basement. We're part of a Jerky Boy tape. Oh, my fucking God.
They can paint each other up.
Oh,
paint each other up.
Shit. Can you go back? I got to hear how uncomfortable this is for everybody. Oh, my God. So it's official. We got duped, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that wasn't him.
Well, Steve, you shouldn't be happy about it.
No, I'm not happy at all. I feel
duped.
Steve.
Mm-hmm. I'm not happy about it at all. I don't like feeling like a jackass any more than anybody else does.
Fantastic.
We got one more piece of the story, and of course, this will be good because Sam's in studio. Sam has no problem just...
Well, I mean, I was duped just like everybody else, and, you know, we can't cast blame on anyone here. But when we... Steve was really happy about it.
Oh, I was gloating. Are you fucking kidding?
Oh, no.
I was proud.
I walked back into the office... And Steve was standing with his arms up in the air and his chest out and his elbows sticking out, saying, and he literally said this.
I'm sure it was bad.
And that's how you executive produce.
Oh, no, you did not.
Wow, did I really say that?
I can't even look at him.
Oh, I can't.
You can actually repeat that to him now and go, and that's how you executive produce.
Wow. Wow.
And a man in my position can't afford to be made to look ridiculous.
Wow, what a schmuck.
And that's how you executive produce, my friends. Let me school you.
He's teaching the boys a life lesson.
This old dog just taught some new tricks.
Yes. He did a little dance with his arms and everything, and that's how you executive produce.
That would have been a dog shit thing to say if you'd actually done the correct booking.
Right? If everything went swimmingly, that's a shitty thing to say.
And that's how you... Oh, I cannot look at Steve.
Met. What makes today look different than another day?
Oh, no. That's how you executive produce.
Oh, that...
That's fucking Beretta. And that's the name of that tune.
Yeah. All right, Rummy.
That's right. Hold on. I got to shoot a money-grubbing cunt right in the belly.
Yeah, Steve, could you say it once?
What?
What Sam said you said.
The way you said it.
Yeah. Stand up and do it.
Please.
And that's how you executive produce. That was good?
That was a little better, yeah.
Thank you.
You know, without even nailing it,
yeah,
we all know exactly what it sounded like. Like, I could picture exactly what it sounded like.
I was a gloating, egocentric douche.
You're in my fucking country.
Yeah. Oh, I was so impressed with my ability to get somebody on the phone.
Yeah. How did your parents find out about the party?
He wanted to make a point to these guys.
Yep.
Basically, he's like, and see, you guys have been wondering for a really long time. This is why I'm here. This is the reason right here.
Yeah, I want to thank Steve for another valuable lesson learned.
Yeah, you're welcome. The next time I need a splash in the face of sarcasm, I'll come see you.
Yes.
All right, get out of here, Steve.
Thank you.
Go work on a dumb character, will you?
That's what I was going to show today.
Ramon, fact check.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer Steve Carlisi.
Hey, it's Ron and Fez here, and we wanted to say just a couple words about our good buddy Steve C.
Steve C was just the sweetest guy there was, and I remember there was a kindred spirit there in loving the Star Wars, loving the comic book movies, loving the toys. Steve loved his toys.
Steve C and I also agreed on one thing. Neither one of us trusted Sam Roberts. And there was a long period of time where we were the only two people who realized that Sam had been bilking SiriusXM out of a lot of money. And we said to ourselves, we're going to get Sam, and we're going to make sure that the bosses know exactly what he's been up into. And then one day, we found a bloody knife in Sam's desk, which had been traced back to me. Because I was so frustrated, I thought, let's just end this now. I'll plant some evidence on him.
And, of course, I'll always remember Steve every time I hear the words,
spy report, spy report.
The man could do more with two words than most people could with full sentences. We'll miss you very much, Steve C.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer Steve Carlisi.
Thank you for joining us. My name is E-Rock. Looking back at our friend Steve Carlisi here, all his time spent on the Opie and Anthony Show. Steve had a lot of memorable segments on the Opie and Anthony Show. This is another fan favorite when we found out that Steve owned a Prius. Now, he bought the Prius so he could save on gas. Priuses are not really the most manliest of cars, and Steve being a big dude in a small electric car. And right after that, we find out that Steve, who was pounding his chest about how great he was doing and saving the environment and all this money with his hybrid, well, guess what? The fucking thing broke down.
Yeah. Steve drives a hybrid, which is just creepy on some level.
I have my hybrid.
Yes, it runs on water and honey and bee energy. I scoop them out and I put them in the gas tank. And as they try to leave, my car goes.
Generates energy.
Stupid. Fucking trying to keep his own little outdoor place.
Bee power. There you go. Yeah, that's all well and fine, you know, the hybrids, but he still pulls up to a gas pump.
Yeah.
He still uses petrol.
I just think they're, like, what are your Mulatta mongrel class of vehicle?
Steve's got the hybrid.
What's wrong with the hybrid?
Nothing. I'm asking. I was actually defending it.
How much does it cost to fill up?
Now it's about $20.50.
$20.50
right
to
there.
Fill up your tank.
Right yeah. There.
How many miles
great.
Do you go?
400 miles on that.
400 miles. I'm noticing I'm getting a little lonely out there in the huge SUV club.
Oh, you certainly are.
You look around. And remember a couple of years back, you could not, you drive down any highway. It was SUV after SUV. Now, not seeing as many.
So your hybrid, which actually gave us a nice ride to Ozfest.
Yeah.
You wanted really to leave early, so I missed Sabbath.
Did it?
But how was
the acceleration, Jim?
The pickup is not that bad. It's a quick little car. It doesn't go really fast. It goes maybe, I've had it up to about 95 miles an hour.
Yeah.
And at that speed, it gets about 12 miles to the gallon, maybe around 11 and a half miles to the gallon. But at
Wait. What? 12 miles a gallon? That's a hunk of shit. I thought it was like 80 miles a gallon.
No. At that speed.
Well, he was going 95 miles
an hour. At 95 miles an hour.
All right, if you're going extremely fast. Yeah.
How would my Saturn, and I'm not trying to name drop, but how much would my Saturn get to a gallon?
I don't, 90 I don't know. Miles an
a
hour?
Rough guess.
Probably not that good much. Either.
No. Oh, okay.
Like, when I'm coasting around the city, this thing gets around 60 miles to the gallon. I mean, you know, when you look at the energy meter, it says it's getting 100 miles to the
gallon.
You
have an energy meter?
The whole
you
got to
get
thing.
In this car. It's half that.
My energy meter.
Yeah, half those meters are bullshit. They're just there spinning and lighting up for no real reason.
Well, it tells you when the engine is shut off, basically.
When the gasoline engine has shut down and you're running on battery power.
When you're running on battery power.
Yeah, exactly. Shit. Where are your batteries stored in the hybrid? In the trunk.
Well, not in the trunk. It's in that area, I
guess. Below the trunk.
Yeah, below the trunk.
Where a gas tank would be.
Yeah. I mean, half of it is like maybe a 10 or 11 gallon gas tank.
How
any
far
problems?
Batteries? Can you go? Like, say you run out of gas. How far can you go on your battery?
I've had it down to zero once, and I went about maybe 20 miles, I think.
And you're on no gas.
On no gas. I mean, but you have to drive pretty slow. You got to drive about 30 miles an hour when you do that.
Why did you run out of gas?
Because I wasn't paying attention.
What could you...
With all those gauges and meters,
you know what?
It
was brand new. It was brand new, and I thought, shit, let's see what this thing can do, and I was on it.
I know what happened.
What happened?
You went to get gas, and when you got out, they thought you were threatening. They didn't realize you were just standing up to look around.
I seem to have run out of petrol. Tigger, could you pump some gas into this, please?
Or something that sounds like that to the attendant.
Wow.
I'm spending a lot less on gas.
Yeah, I got my hybrid. It's a chick magnet.
Well, look, Lexus is making a hybrid Lexus SUV that's coming out. That's actually, I think it's out right now.
Really?
The Highlander is an SUV. Hummer's making a hybrid, which I don't understand because it's going to maybe 14 miles.
What make is yours?
Toyota.
Tell B Power Steve that all the money he's saving on gas will be spent replacing that $500 battery in about 3 years. Also, that big old acid-filled battery causes more damage to the environment than gas.
No, it doesn't.
No, it doesn't.
You don't have it's not vented, right? Not vented batteries.
No.
Yeah, the old style batteries used to leak.
Yeah, it's totally self-contained, and there's selling tons of them. So
have they told you about battery life and how long those things are supposed to last?
I'm sure it's in the documentation somewhere.
It ain't just like going to Sears and buying one of those batteries and popping it under your hood.
Well, no, that's the thing. It does regenerate power. It doesn't. The combustion engine powers the fuel cell while you're driving. So as far as how long that lasts, I don't know. I can look it up though.
Yeah. Chuck from Pittsburgh saying sorry. The increase in my weekly gas cost from $1.60 a gallon to $2.60 a gallon is about $22. The cost of walking away from an accident. Priceless. There you go. I like some steel around me, my friend. How about that? What happens when your car gets rear-ended and you get battery acid all over?
Well, that is the one drawback.
Yeah, yeah, that is a drawback.
You know, the whole fucking car is a crumple zone. I mean,
it's a huge, like, crumple zone of just tinfoil and battery acid is what you drive around in.
Yeah, it's a very light car, hopefully. And if you read about hybrids, you realize that the progression would be to build these things out of lighter, stronger metals.
Of course.
So that, you know, you could build a smaller car that wouldn't
weigh
so much. Composites.
Exactly. Space-age polymers.
Exactly, but that's where it's going.
See you.
Oh, there goes Steve. Steve is driving around in the studio in his hybrid.
Here comes Steve to work.
Steve's doing laps in his hybrid. Cool. Look out. Here he comes.
Steve, he's showing off now. Jesus. There's a bear driving the hybrid.
Clumsy claws are trying to hit the buttons. They're fumbling.
Steve, careful. Oh. It doesn't make sense that you're the one with the hybrid. You should be driving the Hummer. Oh, you need the big vehicle.
I used to have an SUV.
You must be hysterical squeezing into that thing.
No, it's not, it's surprisingly roomy on the inside. Oh, it's been inside it. It's yeah. There's actually a lot of room on the inside.
It's really strange. You can't put anything on your dashboard because it starts off really, really, you know, tiny and gets bigger. All right, hop in it again, Steve. Take another lap around.
It's a hybrid. See him on the side of the highway, broken down with an electrical cord, looking for a place to plug it in.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers Steve C.
Here comes Steve. Where is he? What's the problem?
Well, you know, hybrids are very efficient, but the one way they do perform just like regular cars is when you leave the dome light on all night, it does kill the regular battery.
The dome light on for what, 3 seconds?
Wait.
That's all it took?
What, leaving...
To shut down your hybrid?
Leaving the interior lights on all night, yeah, killed the... killed. It didn't shut off the hybrid engine, so once I got it jumped, it worked just fine, but... The regular electronics, like all like the windows and stuff like that, operate off the same battery that a regular car would operate off of.
And your starter?
Yeah, everything. So like leaving all the lights on would kill the battery just like it would in any other car.
But why would it kill? Did it kill the electric motor that drives your car?
Not at
all.
So
theoretically, you could have backed out under electric power?
Once I got it jumped, the thing worked fine.
I'm not talking about to get it jumped.
That's right.
I mean, could you have backed it out under your electric motor power?
Well, no, because I couldn't start it.
But isn't it just a switch? Because it's...
The electric switch that powers the switch that turns on the car again. The actual switch that turns on that 300-volt electric motor is powered by a normal, regular, diehard battery.
So even though there's enough power to run the electric motor, you can't start it
to
run it on the electric motor.
That I learned last night, or
sucks.
Yesterday morning. Yeah, exactly.
Because you should be able to run it on just the electric motor.
That's exactly what I thought. And once you actually get the thing, once you actually power up the starter and get it going, everything's fine, you know, and it starts pumping the power back into the regular auxiliary battery.
Shouldn't there be a backup that perhaps the batteries that power your electric motor that were fine, that you say, can then be used to maybe jump start your car?
I think there actually is, but I'm not, you know, well versed enough.
Is there? Try it again.
Bad. The old faggot mobile is not starting.
Not a faggot mobile. I am paying a lot less for gasoline.
You gotta jump on a cock and ride that to work.
Did you jerk off in the gas tank?
Come on, Steve. Come on,
All right, well.
Piece of crap.
I'm gonna go work on my new song, Chemistry Got Killed with a Claw Hammer.
So, how'd you get into work?
They gave me a rental until they can.
Ooh.
Yeah. I mean, it's not. It's under full warranty, and they go, okay, we're just going to replace the battery.
So. They gave you a rental. Was it a hybrid rental?
No, it's not, because they can't keep those in the showroom long enough to.
They're flying off the shelves.
They certainly are. Right.
Well, not.
There's another one. You know what? Call me a homo if you want, but you know
all
the fact of the matter is,
homo,
fag.
But there's a year-long waiting list for these cars, so you know.
You know what else is a waiting list for? AZT.
when they only make 100 a year.
Exactly.
That's why there's a waiting list, you idiot. How many are on the assembly line?
Plenty of them.
Oh, stop it.
When we were in Los Angeles, didn't you see all the hybrid cars that were out there?
No, I was too busy whizzing past them in some souped-up rocket car that I rented.
What happened to your car? Did the power surge protector fail? Plug-in vehicle makes me sick.
Steve was driving to work and almost got rear-ended because he pushed in the cigarette lighter by accident, and his speed went down like 20 miles per hour.
doesn't do that.
No.
It doesn't.
I kind of like that one.
Yeah.
I like that. I kind of like this.
It's good format, but my presentation really stunk.
You knew that one was finished.
Yeah.
Because when you said he pushes his cigarette lighter in and then just you kept on trucking and then it tends to slow the car down 20 miles.
I had to pick a speed. Yeah, it really stunk. My presentation blew.
It was just a little mixed up.
Good idea, because I could picture Steve
driving
and then the cigarette lighter and then he slows down because of the battery, you know. But
just the idea of Steve being rear-ended is funny in itself.
That's true.
All right, so Steve. Mean.
No, right. I love you, Steve. But just
why don't you take off there, Steve?
All right. Oh, well,
come on, Steve. Come on, there he goes. All right. Oh.
I pushed that piece of shit out of here.
Opie and Anthony Show remembers Steve C.
Hello, my name is Club Soda Kenny, and I will always remember Steve C. Steve C was always a nice guy to me, and my condolences go out to his family.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer Steve Carlisi.
And it is true. Steve C., who worked with the show for, I don't know, at least 10 years, died. And I'm sick about it. Steve left behind a 2-year-old, a wife, and a stepdaughter who's 16 or 17, I believe. To donate to Steve's family, tinyurl.com/Steve C Fund. If you can give, great. If you can't, don't worry about it. We understand. It's tinyurl.com/Steve C Fund.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer Steve Carlisi.
It's Mike Opelka, stunt brain from the old days. Everybody who's talked about Steve Carlisi has probably used the word unusual to describe him. And while he was unusual, there are better words. Steve Carlisi was a loyal enigma. He was fiercely loyal to Opie, Anthony, Jimmy, the entire show. And while he argued with virtually everybody inside the ONA complex, he defended the place fiercely from all outside attacks. And as far as being an enigma is something that's puzzling, something that's confusing, something that's difficult to understand. Steve Carlisi was an enigma. I worked with Steve for a year, but we stayed in touch long after I left NEW and long after he left Sirius XM. And while we were competing for the same gigs many times, we exchanged information and tried to help each other along the way. I'll always respect him for that. Rest in peace, Steve Carlisi. You will be missed.
Let's go to Winston Churchill.
Winnie?
Well, actually, it's Charlie, and he has something that Winston Churchill said. Charlie.
Good morning, boys.
Hello, Charlie.
Say it like Winston Churchill, please.
I can't do a Winston Churchill.
Come on.
I'm sorry, Ant.
Try it.
I stink. I'm sorry. I stink. Boo. Ant, you might like it. Winston Churchill said, "A nation trying to tax itself into prosperity is like a man standing in a bucket trying to pick himself up by the handle." Pretty interesting.
Ooh.
And that's what
but
we're
that's
doing.
Impossible. You can't do that.
Exactly.
It's impossible.
That's a great line.
That. It is a great line.
That fucking Winston Churchill had some great lines. I wonder if he had a writer.
He didn't have no
Back
writer.
Back then, he would just walk up and say things. This is our finest hour. It's like, wow, it is. Guy's fantastic.
But some schmuck wrote all that shit. They've always had writers.
I don't know.
I think they always had writers.
I think Winnie came up with some quotes of his own.
Why are you calling him Winnie?
That's what you call him, Winnie. That's what they called him back then, Winnie.
Yeah. What?
Standing in a bucket. What are you? It's like, what are you, spackle?
Let's say hi to Steve down the hall. Steve.
Steve down the hall.
Steve down the hall. What's up?
Yes.
Yes, a nation trying to tax itself into prosperity is like drinking cum out of a bucket. How is that? Because taxing yourself is delicious.
Never has one person done so little for so many.
Sorry.
Yes. Oh. Say hi to Stryker.
I may not agree with what you say, but I'll have another piece of cake.
There it is. There it fucking is.
Speak softly, but carry a big burger.
Yes.
Hey, I'm trying to get the instant feedback working. Does it work?
4 score and 1 giant logo ago.
The bucket stops here.
Stryker!
There is nothing to fear but hard work.
I'll laugh at that one.
My only regret is I have but one burger to eat for breakfast.
I may not agree with what you say, but I'll diet for your right to say it.
Ask not what your producer can do for you, because it's nothing.
Wow, you just came up on that, I think. Let's go to Cody in Indiana. Cody!
Give me liberty or give me surgery.
A diet which will live in infamy.
Give me liberty or give me cum. Even if you give me liberty, I'd like some cum. I'll take cum or both, but not just liberty. Liberty is nice, but not without cum, it's not.
Now, let them eat cock.
Steve from Bayshore.
Let them eat cock.
We got Steve on the phone with something. Steve.
Holy shit.
Yes. A cock in the hand is worth 2 in the bush.
No, those are just sayings.
Yeah, no, we're going with
we're
the
going
big political
quotes.
Fucking, yeah. Political quotes, my friend.
I shall not seek, nor shall I accept another term as your producer. Steve. God damn, Steve from Bayshore.
Let's go to Steve on the line. A lot of Steve's checking in. Steve from the moon. Yes, Steve from the moon.
One small step for men. I'm tired.
One small step for man, one giant cock in my behind.
Let's say hi to Steve calling in. Steve C., yes, sir.
One is by land, and the number 2 value meter.
All right.
I kind of like that one.
Yeah. Let's say hi to Steve. Steve.
4 score and 7 cocks ago.
We got Steve C. on the line. Steve C.
4 courses and 7 side dishes ago.
We got Todd. Todd, what's up?
The bukkake starts in 5 minutes.
Let's say hi to Dennis. Dennis?
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this closet wall.
Mr. Gorbachev, give me your balls.
A lot of Steve C's checking in. Steve C.
Give me liberty or give me Mondays off.
That's great. We got Steve C. checking in. Steve? Steve?
Yes.
You're on the...
Yes.
Yes. I know Eric Nagel, sir, and you're no Eric Nagel.
All right.
A house divided, it's against itself, cannot stand.
A stomach divided against itself will not stay small.
All right.
A man divided against his own sexuality cannot stand. However, he can kneel and grab his toes.
Steve C. checking in. Steve. Wow.
Don't fire until you see the lights of your eyes and your cock is down my throat.
Oh, Jesus. Come on. There you go. Let's go to Steve C. Steve C.
Mac, eat cheeseburger.
That's pretty good. You guys want to talk to Steve C today?
Yes.
Is he on?
Yeah, yeah, let's say hi to Steve C. Steve!
Hey, you won't have Steve Carlisi to push around anymore.
To err is human. To be incompetent is divine.
Holy oh, here's shit. A good one. Steve C, check it out. Steve C.
Yes. I could not have sex with that woman.
I could not. Ah, shit. Can't find enough good quotes.
Well, Steve C's checking in. He's got
one. Okay.
Hi, Steve C. What's up?
I had a dream of a cock that tastes like a cheeseburger.
See? He had a dream, but...
let's go to Steve C. Steve C?
Hello?
Hello, Steve
yes,
C.
Yes, Steve.
I want to properly spell potato. Okay. C-O-C-K.
No, that's not even a quote. It's a misstep.
The wheels are falling off. Steve C., help us out here.
And that's how you executively produce a glory hole.
Oof. Oh.
I'm not going to hire American boys to do what Asian boys should be doing.
We might have to expand the bit with Steve C. on line one. Steve C.
Down goes French fries. Down goes French fries.
No, how about down goes me? Down goes me.
Oh, shit.
Let's go to Steve C. Steve C.
Yes. I will suck a cock in space before this decade is out.
It's a cod.
It's a cod. Let's go to
one small step for a man, one deep footprint.
With that, let's say hi to Steve C. Steve C.
Today, I consider myself the laziest man in the country.
Oh, that's a fucking good one.
All right, let's say hi
God
to...
damn
Let's say hi to Steve C. Steve C.
Yes. We have nothing to eat. Buffet itself.
But what itself?
Buffet. Second buffet. Chinese.
All right.
That's
all right,
a good
right.
one.
Yeah, right. We get it.
Steve C., what's up?
Hello.
Hi, yes. Steve.
Read my lips and put some cum on them.
Let's say hi to Steve C. Steve C.
Hey, this is Steve C. from the Old North Church. I just wanted to report that the British are coming. The British are coming, and it's delicious.
Let's say hi to Steve C. Steve C.
Yes. Ask not what you can do for your radio show, but what your radio show can pay you for your own videos.
I shall return on Tuesday.
Let's say hi to Steve C. Steve C.
Yes. Today is a day that will live on in sodomy.
Ha 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 ha. we have Chip on the line. Chip?
No, it's Steve C. Hey, I may not agree with what you say, but you give me a whole bunch of cupcakes or something. I agree with that.
Wow, Chip. How did you do that?
I can't get hung up on me.
Shit. Let's say hi to Steve C on line one. Steve C.
Yes. If you can't stand the heat, stay in the closet.
No. It's regardless of conditions, stay in the kitchen.
One if by land, two if bisexual.
Janine. That was a good one.
Bisexual.
That's very good.
The British are coming in. It's delicious.
And it's delicious.
Oh, he's catching a fucking...
Oh, gets pummeled.
He's catching some fucking right hooks today.
Let's say hi to Steve C. Steve C.
I'm ready for my come shot, Mr. DeVille.
Now, let's go to Steve C. on line seven.
Steve hi, C. Steve C.
Mr. Gorbachev, calm down my throat.
Jesus, that's so unnecessary.
That was just blatant.
Yeah. Let's go to Steve C. Steve C.
Yes, read my lips. I'm a faggot.
Let's go to Steve C. Steve C.
Yes, a house divided against itself to be glued back together with a little cub.
Steve C. Steve C, how
hello?
Are you?
Hello?
Yes. Hi, Steve.
Ich bin ein homosexual.
Let's go to Steve C on line four. Steve, what do you got?
Glory, glory, hallelujah.
It's just fucking wrong.
Let's go to Steve C. Steve!
One giant step for man and two large oven mitts for my canine.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers Steve C.
Hi, this is Sean, formerly of The Opie and Anthony Show. You might or probably don't remember me as The Butcher. I now work for Liquid Metal on Channel 40 here on Sirius XM, and I just wanted to take a quick moment to recollect on my friend and boss, Steve Carlisi. Steve was a great dude. Working for ONA was my first ever job in radio, and Steve always gave me great advice and pushed me to do the best that I could creatively with whatever it is I was working on. He would always have a huge smile on his face, which, believe me, is an incredibly hard task working the crazy hours that these guys do. I can still remember his loud, ridiculous cackle of a laugh echoing through the office. Thank you for everything, Steve. You are a great guy, and you'll be dearly missed. I wish his wife and son all the best. My deepest apologies for your loss.
Ah, good morning.
Wow, good morning, everybody.
I'm calling it right now.
Yeah?
Snow day!
Yeah! Snow day.
You haven't done a snow day show yet, Anthony.
No.
Snow day shows are the funnest Opie and Anthony shows that we could do.
The bestest ever.
The bestest ever, because guess what? It's what? A I don't give a fuck day
exactly.
On the Opie and Anthony show.
Exactly.
Snow day!
Did we take roll call?
You want to take roll call?
Oh, and a roll call. Sound off now. Sam.
Here.
Travis.
Present.
How about Danny?
He's down the hall. He just made it in, though, but he made it.
Yay. Butcher.
Butcher made it.
Yay.
E-Rock.
E-Rock.
Made it.
Yay. Steve Carlisi.
Hold on. Wait for it.
Now,
yeah, the executive producer of the Opie and Anthony show had a real tough time getting in. For the rest of America, it's a goddamn mess in the tri-state area.
Yeah.
It is It is awful out there.
Yes.
I mean, it really is.
It is probably one of the worst like winter storms we've seen in quite some time.
It is just a disaster out there. We don't even have to be here. That's why it's snow day.
Not even supposed to be here today.
But
I'm not even supposed to be.
But Steve started emailing everybody at what? 4:30
Steve Carlisi's day off again. Didn't we do that, Ben?
Yeah, well, we're going to have to redo it, I guess.
Yeah.
Stupid Steve didn't make it in.
No, he sent me an email.
And wait till you hear what Kenny's replacement did to get in here today.
Because that story is nothing less than fucking, like, he should get the Congressional Medal of Honor. Here's Steve's subject matter line. Who is going to have problems / delays getting in? Mm-hmm. And he goes, and I'm stuck. Made it about 100 feet down the road. This sucks. And then Steve Carlisi.
He wrote that from his bed.
Yeah, yeah. No. 100 feet down the road. It wasn't snowing where I was, but then 100 feet away, my goodness, a blizzard.
Yeah, no one goes 100 feet.
100 feet.
You either don't go at all or you go all the way, right?
Yes.
You don't just go 100 feet.
My Prius only went 100 feet and the battery died. I swear to you, I gave it my all. I gave it a try.
Interns that don't even get paid made it in.
Yes.
But Steve, the executive producer of the Opie and Anthony Show.
I made it 100 feet. Wait, I'm checking in. I've made it 110 feet. I'll be there in July.
Like, Steve should be the only one here today.
Only one here, only one not here.
Sam made it all the way from, I don't know where the fuck he lives, way out in the woods somewhere.
Well, Sam and Travis made an interesting, they had an insightful little thing on this whole snow transportation thing. Yeah. What was it?
Choo-choo go in snow.
Choo-choo go in snow.
So as long as you can get to a choo-choo, you can make it into work.
And in the city, choo-choo's pretty available.
Well, I don't know about that. Jersey, it's not like this is the greatest city in the whole damn world.
Oh, with one of the biggest subway systems?
Right.
Oh.
Fucking Steve.
Hey, Danny Ross!
Hey!
Yeah, Danny's in!
I'll tell you, I almost didn't make it in.
It is insane.
We're not saying it's not ugly.
I thought about turning around about 3 or 4 times.
Yeah. Insane, right?
And I hit that point of no return, and I was just like, you made it this far, dude. You just got to go.
But see, you have to come in on these days because it's a snow day show.
Snow day. Yeah.
Remember the last snow day show we had? We had Jimmy and E-Rock running around the place
in bunny outfits.
In bunny, pink bunny outfits.
The hoodie footy snuggle suit.
Yeah. Hoodie footy snuggle suit.
Oh, shit.
What?
He did?
Troy! Yes.
So it's going to end up the only one that didn't make it is the executive producer? Oh, boy, that's not good.
Oh, my God.
That's not good.
I mean, you know how I don't like to defend Steve ever? But, I mean, he does drive the most faggotiest car on the face of the earth.
He certainly does.
With strange defense. With that, Danny, I'm about to tell my story.
Well, first let me just say...
Which isn't going to help Steve at all.
Janine just wrote, and that's how you executive excuse. Very good.
Also, E-Rock was already able to drive in from Jersey, so I don't think in a snowstorm more than one person can drive in.
Can drive in.
I think that's the problem.
Well, that's where the wall of snow must have fallen 100 feet from his house, right behind E-Rock.
So when Kenny's not here... He has this guy, Chris, who replaces him.
Yep.
And Chris is probably the nicest guy I've ever met in my life. I mean, he is like...
That isn't even an exaggeration.
He is so nice, so mellow. Yep. Nothing bothers this guy. He's about to kill somebody.
Yeah.
That's how bad it is outside. So when Steve wrote that he made it 100 feet and then he said, screw this, and gave up. Well, Chris's story is a little different. Here he's coming down the hall.
Yeah.
Chris, I don't know if he's allowed on the air. Chris told me that to make sure that he was going to be able to come in today, he plowed his driveway 3 times.
Now, he lives in, I think...
He can't be on the air probably,
no,
right?
No. Where do you live? Northern Jersey?
Yeah, he lives north.
He lives in the place that just got pounded by this.
There's over 2 feet of snow where you live.
Yeah, 2 feet.
Easily, right?
Okay, so he's coming from an area that's gotten 2 feet of snow. In New York right now, we're up to about nine inches.
Yeah, and
so north are where it's just completely a disaster.
No sign of stopping either, by the way.
No. So well, Steve's on the line. Jesus Christ.
Oh, no.
Hold on a minute. You're messing up my story.
I apologize. I just wanted to call in and give the faggot incompetent executive producer reasoning for not being there.
Oh, I thought we were doing a good job of that.
Yeah. No. You were doing a horrible misrepresentation.
Oh.
So, Steve, why can't you make it in even though everybody else on the Opie and Anthony staff made it in?
Dude, if I lived here...
I saw... The audience saw it coming. The audience saw that coming.
Snowden!
Yes!
Oh, shit. I ain't listening to his horseshit today.
I saw LOLs popping up on this screen when you started asking the question.
Fuck that.
Holy motherfucker! Money. Here's why.
See, he's so pissed off right now.
Oh, he's freaking out.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers Steve C.
Hello, this is Stomper Patty, and I'm here to reminisce about Steve, our dear friend. I always remember him as a very, very nice person. He was like a teddy bear. You know, I guess Steve the Bear, you know, that's my impression. He was always nice to me, and, you know, it's just hard, you know, to say goodbye to someone that you like a lot, you know? You know, I guess, you know, he did everything that he had to do on this earth. And to me, he's with God. He's in a better place. He's not suffering anymore. And we're all going to miss him. I'm going to miss him dearly.
Hi, this is Coke Logic, contributor to the Opie and Anthony Show and longtime listener. Over the years, I've done animation for the show, and I always knew it was going to be good if Steve C. was going to make an appearance. Simply because Steve C. had the sunglasses on top of his head, the sleeveless black shirt, arm tattoos, and a flaming logo on his chest. The look he created in life was perfect for a cartoon character, because Steve C. was instantly identifiable, even if it was a cameo in the background without dialogue. And the fun part about animating Steve is he was mostly reaction shots. You have people from the show tearing into Steve, Anthony with some sideways compliment, and then Jim with a borderline mean-spirited, hilarious comment. And then you would cut to Steve C.'s reaction shot, just looking down like, when is this over, or rolling his eyes, because Steve knew it was good radio, to just stay there and take it for the show. And that's how I imagine his reaction. Steve was an amazingly nice guy, and I was glad to have met him. It's a terrible shame, but I can't imagine I'll ever forget him.
Hey, guys. This is Pat from Monarchy. We're all going to miss Steve C. He was a great guy and a mental case like the rest of us ONA fans. He was always supportive of my buffoonery, and as far as I'm concerned, he'll forever be the voice of the Opie and Anthony Show. Ramon, you are officially released from your servitude. Take it easy, Steve. Goodbye.
Hey, this is Steve from Bayshore. I just wanted to say a couple of things about Steve C. The first time I really dealt with him was when I had written and recorded a song for Little Jimmy spoofing Elvis's version of My Way. The song was called My AIDS, and it was not a hit with Steve C. I was not insulted by that, but the song sort of fell by the wayside for a few days until Club Soda Kenny brought it to the show's attention. They called Steve in to ask him about it. He said he didn't like it, and the guys played it and liked it. So later in that day, Steve emailed me saying, "Oh dear, I'm sorry, I was wrong," or something to that effect. And I thought that was pretty cool of him. So we struck up a little correspondence every now and again. Eventually, I was hired to write the show rundown for K-Rock. I had to deal with Steve once in a while. And he also hired me to do some writing for his foundrymusic.com website. We worked on a couple of little animation scripts together. And I had a really good time with the guy. Every time I saw him, he was really nice to me. Very cool, very easy to laugh, and was genuinely a nice guy. I really have nothing but good memories of Steve C., and I'll miss talking to the guy every so often. He was really a nice guy, and my thoughts go out to his family and friends. Thanks for listening.
Hey, this is the gate. I'm a regular on the Open Anthony show. It always made me laugh when Steve see always porn videos were real and had to be told they were fake. And also ends an impression of Steve is really very funny. My condolences to Steve Scalise's family. He will be missed. Goodbye.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer Steve Carlisi.
And it is true. Steve C., who worked with the show for, I don't know, at least 10 years, died. And I'm sick about it. Steve left behind a 2-year-old, a wife, and a stepdaughter who's 16 or 17, I believe. To donate to Steve's family, tinyurl.com/Steve C. Fund. If you can give, great. If you can't, don't worry about it. We understand. It's tinyurl.com/Steve C. Fund.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers Steve C.
Hey, it's Sam Roberts, of course. Steve was the guy who I knew from the very beginning of working with ONA. He was actually the guy who interviewed me when I was just trying to be an intern. And he was the one who I pestered to get the internship. And when I finally got here, he was the one who I pestered most days. He could take a joke, though, better than anybody who I've ever encountered. He was willing to throw himself under the bus for the betterment of the show more than anybody who's ever been associated with the show. And that's because he liked to laugh. Like, he enjoyed having a good time, even if the laugh was at his expense. Even if he was angry at first or frustrated at first, eventually, Steve would always be there laughing with you. The worse you got him, the harder he laughed. Eventually, but he did laugh. He was the first person. He was the guy who made me into the sort of shit stirrer that I've become on the show, because when I was young, he saw me kind of just goofing off in the office all day, and he sat me down one day and he said, "Sam, seriously, you have got to stop fucking around." That's what he said. He said, "You have got to stop fucking around." He said, "All you know, you're goofing around and it's becoming a distraction. Unless what you're doing is going to be something that is brought to the air, then you need to not fuck around anymore." And I said, "Okay, Steve, that's understandable." And from that moment on, and Steve was fully with it, I said, "So that means that if I am going to bring it to the air, I can still goof around?" And he said, "Of course." And he meant every word of it, too, because I didn't stop goofing around. I just brought everything to the air. And Steve was happy with that. I mean, there was every character I've ever done, just about, from AJ Poopy Shits to the inventor and Epstein to all of this stuff, was stuff that Steve basically forced me into a studio to do, because he wanted all this creative energy to be put on the air, because he knew that's what would be best for the show, and that's what would be funniest. If it was throwing me under the bus, if it was throwing himself under the bus, Steve was okay with it, as long as what turned out was a funny product. We all miss Steve here, and we're all saddened by everything. I hope that you're enjoying this special as much as I am, and I hope that everybody sort of understands now, you know, in hindsight, that as many laughs as we had that sort of that seemed like they were at Steve's expense, Steve was having them with us, and the laughter was the reaction that he wanted. So thank you for everything, Steve.
Hey, Anthony, we got to get Steve in here. He's working on our coming or going game.
Uh-huh.
Steve, how's the coming or going
hands
game going?
Hands tucked in up to the nipples.
Coming,
Jesus, Steve. Pull the shirt out.
It's a medium.
God.
He's a tuck kind of guy.
Stop
looks so
tucking.
Much better untucked, little V-neck.
I
Stop
nothing
tucking.
I do.
That looks good.
No, no. You're everything making, I do, everything I wear.
Back off the mic a little bit.
So it's just,
I like that. I like that's the loose guy.
Right. Yeah, much better. You're making us all very uncomfortable. You really like to tuck that shirt
it's
all
like
the way
Lebanese.
In.
What are you hiding? A bomb belt?
we should make a shirt up for him that says, "Go tuck yourself." Good natured shirt.
So I told you to tuck your mother.
At least he's
boom bang.
At least he doesn't have any flames on his attire today.
I bet you his boxers do. No.
He sent me an email yesterday. He got all excited because on eBay they're selling boots with flames.
Ugh. Yeah,
and you want to make a bid on those, don't you?
Henry, yeah. Well, I'm trying to tuck this, bro. Here's a little help here. Joe brought it. Doesn't like big, thick Lebanese fingers.
Every day, it never gets old.
You big tattooed tucker.
All right, so how's the coming or going game going?
It's going well.
You think we'll do it today?
No, we won't do it today. I actually have a good stash at home that I have to pull for
three.
Wow.
All right.
No, it's got to be good.
We're going to have to find
As I'm doing this.
Are we going to have it on Skull Shirt Day or Flame Shirt Day?
Flame Shirt Day.
But you know what? Even Skull and Flame Shirt Day are Roll Up the Edge of the Shirt Sleeve and Iron It Day. Is there any reason... Is there any reason, I wish people in Radio Land could see the fact that this sociopath is wearing a black t-shirt and he rolls up the part of the edge of the black sleeve and then irons it so there's like a little a cuff.
That's to show off those big biceps. Look at that size.
I spent months getting my arms tattooed. Why not show them off?
I know, but you only do it a quarter inch. Just get a tank top. Show off the arm.
He probably measures it with a tank measure.
You know why? Because I walk in here with a tank top and it's more ammunition for
I wouldn't make fun of your tank top.
That's true.
Yeah. Right.
You know the pressure now every day probably wakes up and looks at the shirts and goes, "No, I can't even." Yeah.
No,
I know I'm going to catch up.
You know what? If I cared enough what Jim thought, you know, do you realize the irony in me taking wardrobe criticism from you?
Ah, good.
Oh,
now you got to give him credit for that one.
I can't even argue with it. I'm an awful dresser.
Yes,
but I'm acknowledging I'm an awful dresser.
But see, Norton's not trying though. He doesn't care. It seems like you got something going on here.
I got a look going. You
really are trying for a look.
I don't care what Jim thinks of my look.
But how does it feel that when you pull into a gas station, people run?
I don't even know what that meant.
Because there's flames.
I got it.
Yeah, of course you did.
I carried the two. I did the math problem. That was good. All right.
Just wait until you see the boots. That's like it.
Are you really going to get the boots?
I already got them. Not the ones I showed you last night. They didn't have those on my side.
You got to come into work with the flaming boots.
Yeah, they are.
When are you moving to Chelsea, by the way?
They're shipped in from
He needs a roadster.
England.
He's the kind of guy that would drive a roadster with the flames on it.
Like, I would.
The look is perfect to get out of that.
We got
to
get him on American Chopper.
Yeah.
You're perfect
like
for American Chopper.
He's the type of guy you see holding hands with another guy, but not like in like one of those hardcore male fist clubs.
Oh, like the wow.
The type of guys.
I didn't see that coming.
The type of guys that like shake hands like this. How you doing? And then like kiss deep in the middle of the street.
Ooh.
I'm not knocking him. I'm just saying that those. You ever see those guys? Like those are the gay guys that you
don't. Yeah, Anthony and I see those guys all.
Yeah,
what?
Yeah.
Where the fuck did you get that from?
You never saw the guys, the leather bar guys?
Only in that movie that Pacino was in, Cruising.
Oh, that was, he wears the yellow handkerchief.
Yeah.
I just like watching.
You know he's got some flaming shoes. The kind of pyro would admire. He makes contestants bring in food. And he runs the Foundry music empire. Martini Steve's clothes are on fire. Martini Steve's clothes are on fire. He only buys flaming attire. His clothing's like a barbecue. His laundry never needs a dryer. If you're selling burning shoes, this drunken Lebanese will buy 'em. Martini Steve's clothes are on fire. Martini Steve's clothes are on fire. He only buys flaming attire. Yeah, you know he's got some flaming shoes. The kind that Satan would desire. If you're with him drinking booze, the smoke detector is required. Martini Steve's clothes are on fire. Martini Steve's clothes are on fire. The only
Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer Steve Carlisi.
Hey, it's Don Wicklund from SiriusXM. I was ONA's program director from 2005 till the merger, and of course worked with Steve C. and the crew for all those years. Many good years, a few bad ones, but great memories from live broadcasts. I remember working with the entire crew, and of course with Jimmy and Open Ant. And Steve was my go-to executive producer for most of those years. He made sure the producers did their jobs. They provided the best show prep for Opie and Anthony. And every day, every night, Steve and I would talk. And it wasn't just about work. It was about life. It was about how happy he was with MJ. It was how the world revolved around her and the day he found out that he was going to be a dad. I remember he called me and he let me know as soon as he heard the news. You could see brand new Steve emerge from the rubble of the daily grind of work. For once, it was like work was put on the back burner and his life was all that mattered. I think a lot of days we spent bitching about work and the staff and the issues with the channel and the frustrations of getting legal to sign off on every stunt we wanted to, but we pushed and we pushed legal and we made it through with a lot of the stuff that the guys wanted to do. And you know, that's what I miss about Steve. He was passionate. He was a go-getter. He lived for the show, and he made me a proud program director. I think one of my favorite times with Steve is we were out of our element and away from work at one of the most perfect settings. It was one of the most relaxing days ever. It was Opie's wedding in Philly. I remember it like yesterday. Sitting at our table with our wives, smiling from ear to ear, as we had the perfect life. We had the perfect wives, happy as hell, and then sharing that day with the staff and, of course, with Opie and Lindsay. For one day, we didn't think about work. We thought about life, how great it was to spend time outside of our jobs, just having the greatest time ever at one of the most beautiful weddings to date. And all I can see in my mind is Steve looking at MJ, just smiling, dancing, making a fool out of himself because he did suck at dancing. But he was the happiest guy in the world. It's those good memories that you never want to forget. It's the pictures that still remain in my mind. It's good people like Steve that will never be forgotten. We love you, Steve. We miss you, man.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer Steve Carlisi.
And it is true. Steve C., who worked with the show for, I don't know, at least 10 years, died. And I'm sick about it. Steve left behind a 2-year-old, a wife, and a stepdaughter who's 16 or 17, I believe. To donate to Steve's family, tinyurl.com/Steve C Fund. If you could give, great. If you can't, don't worry about it. We understand. It's tinyurl.com/Steve C Fund.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer Steve Carlisi.
Something happened this week that was very disturbing to all of us, and it was the passing of our friend Steve Carlisi. When I first got involved with XM 202, the first person I emailed, and I can't remember exactly how it went down, but I emailed Steve, and he answered me right back, which spoiled me because I wrote to Anthony and never got an... No answer. I wrote to Opie, mailbox full, you know, but every time I would email Steve, he would always email me back. And I can't say that we struck up a friendship real early on, but we had this correspondence going, and he was a nice guy, and it didn't matter how trivial the email was, he always responded to me. And, you know, then I sort of got hooked up with Jim Norton when we were talking about something. He talked about this on the air, so I can say it. He had a lump on his nut or something. I can't remember, in his scrotum. I can't remember what it was.
Don't remember what it was, but you can talk about it on the air.
Well, but he talked about it on the air, so...
right, whatever it was.
So whatever it was, it's okay for me to mention that we talked about it, but that's how he and I started talking. And when Opie put out that message that if a fan had an idea for a show, let them know and they'll consider it. The first person I went to was Steve Carlesi, and he got back to me within 5 minutes of my emailing him, and his response was, "I like the idea a lot. Let me see what I can do." And the rest is history. There would be no Weird Medicine if it wasn't for Steve C. And, you know, anytime we went up there, Steve always went out of his way to say hello to us.
Yeah.
Even when I dragged all you other assholes up there. I mean, he came and said hello.
To all of us.
And he was busy, yeah, but he always made time. And he was just a very, very nice guy. So we're going to really miss him. You know, stuff like this happens. It's just, you know, he's too young. He's got a kid and a wife and a stepdaughter. And, you know, it just kind of took everybody broadside. So he will be greatly missed.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers Steve C.
Remembering our good friend Steve Carlesi. Steve C., former producer of The Opie and Anthony Show. My name is A-Rock. Thank you for checking this out in this segment here. This has been a long time coming. We knew about this that he had this, and nobody really decided to explore it until one day Steve decided to bring this in, the official CD of the band Foundry. Now, Foundry was Steve's band back up in Boston in the mid to late 90s, which led to Foundry Music. It used to be a band site, and then he just kept the name and turned it into the global enterprise that it became. But this was the album for the band Foundry that nobody has ever heard up until this point. So, of course, O&A, you know, we go through the CD, we go through the lyrics, then we play what became extremely popular worldwide because of the Opie and Anthony Show. We broke this record, Pendulum. This is the debut of Pendulum, the debut of Foundry. There's a lot of material that came from the playing of this album, and this song alone eventually led to a Pendulum cover song contest. And just would always be brought up at the weirdest times. Steve C., Foundry Music, Pendulum, right now.
Steve, where's your music?
Yeah.
He goes right here. Like, he looks so sad and dejected.
Come on, Foundry.
No energy. He's like, it's right here.
Where is it? Give me that CD
before he thinks about taking it back.
No, I can't take it back.
I want to enjoy the whole CD. Give it to me.
All right.
The cover art. The name of the CD you guys put out was What Kills Me?
That's right.
Our own Steve.
Very aggressive.
And you were the singer?
Uh-huh. Why not? How'd your parents die? Why not? How'd your parents die? Why not? How'd your parents die? I'm never talking to you again, Jimmy. That's terrible. I'm sorry.
Did you hand the CD to Ant and I when we were working at AAF?
I might have. I think I...
probably.
Yeah. I was part of a group called Foundry. It was very hard to find and navigate.
Come here.
Oh!
I probably did because I used to work those beach parties that you guys did at what was that Fitchburg Center?
Fitchburg,
whatever that stupid indoor hockey arena was. Where you guys
the indoor beach party in Fitchburg, Massachusetts.
Because I would work security at those things.
Where's all the other guys?
Could you just give this a listen?
I guarantee you, Steve, right now is secretly hoping that there's a big talent scout listening.
No, I'm not.
Who will recognize that Foundry was a band that was overlooked?
Trust me, I've heard enough. I've heard enough. Demo CDs and befriended enough of the guys that I grew up listening to know that this is not going to be.
Isn't it exciting, though, when you finally get the package in your hand and you're a band and you're like,
yeah,
here it is, man. Oh. It's going to make it, man.
You guys all listen and tap your toes.
At the time, 10 years ago, yeah, you're ecstatic. Yeah. You're like, wow.
Guys, you guys weren't looking at this closely.
Oh, no, what?
I'm bummed that you guys don't have thank yous.
Yeah, those are always
your
fun.
CD.
I thought we did.
But, Steve, would you like to let everyone know what your rock name was?
Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah. Stephen Carr. That's right.
let me clarify one thing.
Oh, boy.
I forgot about that.
If I find out, if you spelled it C-A-R-R,
yeah,
I'm going to smash arms you? Into your face.
Yes, I did.
Fucking cocksucker.
Grr.
Steve Hybrid it is now.
Steve Carr.
Let me try to start myself.
No.
I'm out of gas.
No.
And this is Steve Carr on vocals.
I forgot about that.
Steve Carr. Was Steve douche taken?
Everybody in the band had like a very antiseptic, cool last name, and I was the one guinea in the group.
Steve Carr, I
had to fit in.
Carr, yeah.
That's fucking wonderful. Horrendous.
better than Steve Lisi.
Exactly.
Steve Lisi or Steve Carr.
It's a good name.
I Lisi my.
Hold on. I gotta tell myself. It was a good one, too, you bastard.
Steve Carr.
Stumble over
my
own
tongue. I wish I would have seen that. I didn't catch
it. Well, there it is, right
C-A-R-R.
There.
C-A-R-R.
R-R. Foundry is Stephen Carr, lead vocals and guitar.
Stephen Carr.
A bunch of dummies.
Stephen Carr.
Practice his autograph. Steve.
Yeah. Oh, I did. I
and
used
the
to.
The two R's trailed off.
No, the T used to intersect every other letter, I think. Yeah, it was awful.
Steve Carr.
Carr.
Steve Carr. Steve Carr. Carr.
Thank you, sweetie.
Oh.
No, I
Steve.
Want to
read on
that.
Oh, let's see your autograph. Come on, Steve
back
Carr.
Then, we should do old-time concert commercials for Foundry.
Steve Carr.
Steve Carr.
Featuring Steve Carr.
How many times did you rehearse the speech at the Grammys? they normally don't recognize this kind of music.
I'm sure I had those conversations with myself, in the shower or at night. When I win that Grammy.
Large boy.
All 400 pounds of me.
All right, Steve. Imagining, Jeopardy having a question, this lead singer of a popular band is actually named Steve Carlisi, and everyone knows it. Who is Steve Carr? Steve Carr is correct.
That's right.
Yes, Steve Carr.
This band actually put out one CD, and it sucks a bag of ass. Who's found it?
Wow. This was everything to this guy back in 97.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, what song should we play?
Steve Carr should have gone to the junkyard to be crushed.
Steve Carr should have carried Harry Chapin on his back.
Steve Carr should have baby seats in the back backing into a lake.
Steve Carr should have a hose taped to the side of his face.
Really awful.
Steven Carr.
Steve Carr.
I used to wear these awful get-ups with, since I was so big, I couldn't buy stage clothes in normal, I couldn't buy off the rack, so I was going to Lane Bryant, the fat woman.
Oh, my God.
The fat woman shop.
Steve Carr gets his clothes from me, Lane Bryant. We'll tell you more in this issue of Tiger Beat.
And I had this, yes, indeed.
Oh, God damn. How did this go so long? How long have we known Steve?
I have kept this intentionally.
8 years?
Eight years I've kept this muffled.
All right, God. So you would go to Elaine Bryant, and what would you buy for your crazy stage outfit?
A 3X leopard skin blouse.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
Oh.
Wow.
I had that. I had gold sequined Doc Martens. I had,
You're divine.
Yeah.
You are divine.
Yeah. I think I had
that's terrible. I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's more than terrible.
My girl wants to borrow my shirt all the time.
Steve Carr.
Oh, you stink.
It was awful. I wore black eyeliner when I was...
We got to blow up the lyrics because they're really ridiculous.
Oh, his lyrics. Why didn't I look at that?
Oh, yeah.
Because you're just not observant, Jimmy.
What kills me? Wow. Music by Stephen Carr. Lyrics by Stephen Carr.
Ew, you were Stephen Carr?
Stephen Carr.
Like Stephen Tyler?
Right.
It's hard to read.
Stephen Hawking, Stephen King.
Did you think about it? Should it be Steve Carr or Stephen Carr?
What was the big hit? What Kills Me?
I'm trying to think. Yeah, that was
the
one
hit. That was the hit.
I want to live. I want to dream. I want to fly. I want to die.
I think there was one. I think the one that was called Tell Your Story was the one that.
And by hit, we are just leaving the S off the front.
Yeah, exactly. They're all crap.
Please blow up the lyrics so we can hear. We can sing along.
And the course of my existence isn't yours to compromise.
That was written by.
I want to love. I want to hate.
I want to punch a girl in her vagina. Yes.
I want to do promos that nobody gets.
I want to turn and deviate.
Play the hit Ramon.
Bring me a cloth. A little taste. What song you want us to play?
You can play the first one. That's fine.
Yeah.
Pendulum?
Yeah.
Pendulum.
They all have long...
As performed by Stephen Carr in the band Foundry.
Swings back and forth like a pair of balls when you're wearing a Lane Bryant dress.
It was a blouse, Jimmy.
A blouse.
Stephen Carr.
Stephen Carr.
Wow.
We're waiting for the lyrics to be blown up.
Okay.
We want to sing along.
No,
people are just all, they're suggesting Photoshops now that are just,
I'm sure. I kept this so under wraps for so long, and I knew that it was going to
happen. Ted Kennedy should drive you into Chappaquiddick. Steve Carr crash. Oh, man.
Strap in.
Strap in.
I remember Jimmy, when I told Jimmy about this, he looked at me and he just was laughing. And I said, what are you laughing about? He said, I'm just trying to decide if we're going to get 1 or 3 hours out of this.
You knew it had to be.
You're getting thrown under the car.
What are the rest of the boys doing in the band?
I think one of them is still playing in bands in Boston. The other guys all had day jobs, you know, and that's what kept everybody in Boston. And I was just like, I don't want to do this anymore. And I moved back to Jersey because it was just the scene in Boston was Godsmack and everybody else at that point. And I think Stained was just starting up at that point, too.
Godsmack and Foundry would be a good
Foundry. Yeah, I think so, too. Bill.
Sully and Stephen Carr posing for a magazine.
Stephen Carr.
If only.
That's what he wanted.
I know. Yeah, that's what you want.
What you wanted, right?
At 22, that's dream. What I wanted. I wanted to be. I thought I wanted to be a rock star, and then I came to the realization that everybody.
You get copies for everybody.
Godsmack and Goddreck.
Here, Jimmy. God, even blown up. The lyrics are beyond tiny.
Very tiny. Had to fit all of my creativity in a very small space.
Oh, we were broke. We recorded this in 2 days in a, I think it was in Alston or something like that, some studio.
All right, here come the lyrics. So we're going to play Pendulum?
Yeah, you can play
by one. Foundry?
That's
oh
right.
God.
That's
with
right.
Stephen Carr on
all these songs
guitar.
There's somebody
vocals
out there. You guys ever play a show?
Yeah, a bunch.
Did you?
Yeah.
All right, here we go.
So I don't even get the first line.
What's the first line?
Pendulum will swing at the center of attention. Just another day. Condescension.
Another condescension. Yeah.
Oh, just another. It says day. Mock you, shock you, gonna lock you down.
All right, wait a minute. Pendulum will swing at the center of attention. How does a pendulum swing? Everyone's looking at it swing?
I guess, yeah.
All right.
Pendulum.
Did you just look
shift
for things that rhymed and right around?
No,
us?
I did have a rhyming dictionary.
Pendulum will shift with a little bit of pressure. Move too slow, and the pendulum will get you.
It's the pendulum that will get you.
Show you, mow you, gonna throw you around.
Ew, show you, mow you,
mow
how appropriate.
You.
Maybe we shouldn't pay this place.
You did the...
God, I can't take this picture of you, though. It should have been Stephen as big as a...
Yeah.
Wait till you see line 3. This is where the writing gets good,
Stephen. Oh,
okay.
Hindenburg.
You did the crime, but not the time. You went there, didn't you?
You did the crime.
Don't do the crime if you can't do the time.
What was the crime you committed? Impersonating a retarded person writing lyrics?
Now you got to pay for what you done. You better run. I've had all I can take of all your screaming in my ear. My back is going to break if you push
me in the rear.
Push it in my rear.
If you push me one more time. It doesn't even rhyme.
It does. If you hear the rhyme scheme at all.
My back is going to break.
Exactly.
My heart's getting heavy. My blood's getting cold.
Steve!
I was 22.
It's like one of Jimmy's poems.
It really is. Yeah. You make me look like fucking Mammoth.
No, I don't.
I wasn't a poet, but you get it. You change me into something that I just can't control. If you see me coming, best get out of my way.
Got no choice in the matter.
Yeah, exactly.
Shaped like a bulldozer.
If you see me coming, put on certain glasses and you'll see me pass in front of the sun.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
Because the pendulum is swinging back the other way. Pendulum can take only so much yelling, but he'll do next.
What
he'll do next.
There's no telling. Like dog shit, this song is smelling.
Bump you, chump you, gonna dump you out. Pendulum will break under too much tension, breaking down the walls of my detention. Wrecking, balling, kingdom fallen down. And that is all the words to Pendulum.
Oh, wow.
So now you can follow along at home with the actual music from the band Foundry, ladies
Listen
and gentlemen.
Listen to the words.
Is there a little intro music?
Yeah, all of our songs had very long intros.
The very long intros.
The electric
course,
drum triggers and all.
Oh, great.
What instrument did you play, Sweetie Pie?
Guitar.
Eric.
Here's the man.
As that tiny little thing in front of me would indicate.
Oh, I see.
Blown up bigger, and so is Steve in this picture. You are just a shell of your former self. I am so proud to look at you now.
Thank you, Anthony.
When you were giant.
How much did you weigh back then? 1650.
Pushing 400. Jesus. I mean, at that point, who's counting? I really was huge. All I have like a 50-inch waist, I think.
All right. Wow. Pendulum. Okay, good. All right, here we go.
Get ready to rock.
Cut off the top of Pendulum.
Here it is, people. Foundry.
I'm the only station that really rocks. This
That's
is Foundry.
Right.
Pendulum.
Featuring Stephen Carr on lead vocals and guitar.
Stephen Carr going to be joining us in studio later on.
Talk
about his new album.
This is Pendulum on the only station that really rocks.
Yeah. This is so good. I repress this. Here it comes.
That's terrible. I'm sorry. Get the fuck out now. Why not? What are you doing in my house? Get the fuck out. No, nothing's wrong. Just stay in the living room. I'll handle it.
Well, it's... Steve can't take it, man. He's tapping out. Yeah! Oh, obligatory guitar lead.
I forgot about that.
Yeah!
Buried in reverb.
Wild stallions. Uh-oh. Yeah, bring it down. Every bad boy has a soft side.
Ow! You see me coming, let's get out of my way.
The pendulum is swinging back the other way. That's terrible, I'm sorry.
No.
Grr. 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 Grr.
No.
Why not?
No.
There you go, Foundry. Pendulum on the only station that really rocks.
You know what?
It's
not that bad. You got to be honest with the guy. Yeah. It's not that bad.
It's not.
No, it's not that good either.
No, it's all right.
It's not that bad.
Considering
we were hoping it was a lot worse. Trust me.
Yeah.
Let's see. Well, the instant feedback doesn't think so.
Yeah, I'm sure they don't. I'm sure they're full with
savage animal.
Oh yeah,
he sings monotone too.
I want to hear you sing something.
Like what? I sing jingles all the time. You've heard me sing before.
Steve from Philly. Is the singer a great big fat person?
He
sounds like the announcers, the news announcer from South Park. Okay.
Sing a little something a cappella. I know you can.
Like what?
Who's fronting the band? Kim Jong-il from Team America. A lot of people have thrown in the South Park reference. Steve once bit the head off an ostrich on stage. Is that true?
I got a question. I'm
hungry enough.
Do you got a slow one?
Yeah, but
Power ballad?
No power ballad.
No.
But you slowed it down?
I slowed it down on one track that I wrote for my sister, but I don't want to play that
one. You can't play that one.
Oh, all right.
The honey pot is swinging back the other way.
What other one you want to play there, Steve?
Let me see the thing.
The pendulum is swinging.
I'm telling you, I haven't heard this in years. Yes,
you
have. Quite intentionally.
He makes them play at parties.
My mother plays this at her house, and she's like, because she's so proud. She's like, my son did this. And I'm like, Mom, turn it off.
She couldn't be proud. She probably does that when people are like going to eat and they shouldn't eat. She puts it on and it just wrecks their appetite.
Let's see.
Or when you're all blocked up and you can't shit. They have this in the bathroom.
She plays it when she wants to empty the house.
Yeah, when she wants the company to leave.
Yeah, the company needs to go home.
Mrs.
Crank up some Foundry.
This is my son.
Haven't heard anything like that since the song from Boogie Nights in the studio. Hello, exactly.
But the magic that's on that tape is ours.
We look like assholes, man.
You could do
I'm Stephen Carr.
The Opie and Anthony Show remembers friend and producer Steve Carlisi.
Well, that's it for us, and I'd like to thank you for checking out the Steve Carlisi tribute special, looking back at the life and times of Steve Carlisi here on the Opie and Anthony Show. Steve, as we've been saying, had recently passed away and left behind a wife, a stepdaughter, and a 2-year-old son. We couldn't be more upset about this. It was very unexpected and really put his family in a hard position. I want to thank all of you who have been donating to the Steve Carlisi Fund. You can check it out at tinyurl.com/SteveCFund. Your donations mean the world to this family who are going through some rough times right now. And we thank you here at the Opie and Anthony Show for your look. We know that we say our listeners are a bunch of dicks and assholes and just some of the most vile, evil people on the face of this earth. But there are times where you out there can show some humanity and a softer side to your viciousness and rally up and come through when the cause is needed. So we thank you for that. We raised a lot of money and we hope to continue doing so. So that about wraps this up here. We miss Steve. We wish nothing but the best for his family. This is a really shitty situation that we're all in. It's very sad to lose somebody. We've lost a lot of people in the last 2 years, and not that they needed to be on the list, but Steve did not need to be on this list either. And so we'll end this with this was the lyrics to this song were on his, I guess you call it a prayer card when you're at a wake and a funeral and they give you out those, they give out those little cards with some kind of, religious inspiration to help you through a hard time. This card had the lyrics to this song on here. It's Rascal Flatts, I'm Moving On. It seemed fitting to end the show with this song. So here it is. Steve, we miss you. We love you. And, rest in peace.
I'm moving on. At last I can see life has been patiently waiting for me. And I know there's no guarantees, but I'm not alone. There comes a time in everyone's life when all you can see.
sold what I could and packed what I couldn't. Stopped to fill up on my way out of town. I've loved like I should, but lived like I shouldn't. I had to lose everything to find out. Maybe forgiveness will find me somewhere down this road. I'm moving on.
And that's how you executive produce.